Yeah, so that's what's going on, see? And you know what I mean? Guys already told us, you know, what's going on for those of us who got a good grasp of this book of remembrance, right? And the word of Yah. That's why, again, chapter 42, Yeshayah, verse 9, before it spring forth, I tell you of it. I'm going to do new things. Before it come forth, I tell you of it. Why does he tell, you understand, his servant up there, 42nd chapter, Yeshayah? What does he say? Behold, my servant, my elect, in whom my soul delights, I put my spirit upon him. Well, why is he telling him? Because he's going to tell the people. See? Simple as that. He's going to bring it out. He's going to sprinkle the monarchy. He's going to tell the people. He's going to bring it to them. He's going to illuminate the Edomite. He's going to start setting up Yah's government. Yeshayah chapter 9, verse 6. This is a roadmap that this book will remember. Everything that Yah said has to come to pass. Nothing returns unto Yah void, right? Chicago Tribune, October 11th. Northern California fires kill at least 15. 100,000 acres of fire. Reports of hundreds missing. There you go. You can see, right? Also, IQ test challenge adds to strain in Trump camp. Advisor calls president's comment a joke, but Tillerson may not find tension funny. Okay? Now, you understand? Because Tillerson, he called Trump a moron. Okay, he hasn't denied it yet because he truly called him that, you know, behind closed doors. You know what I'm saying? You're a moron, and he is. You follow what I'm saying? But so is the Illuminati Edomite that put Trump there. He's a moron. Like I say, what did y'all say he was going to do? If you have no wisdom and understanding, you're a moron. You're a heathen without a doubt. Right? If you have no wisdom or understanding, you're a heathen. You're a moron. You're liable to say and do anything. And you definitely going to be more likely than not prideful and arrogant. I see it every day. I can look out the window and see the ones out there walking in my community. I don't have a bit of wisdom or understanding, but they got pride. And they exhibit it all the time. Their pride and arrogance. Okay? So Trump, when the word got back to him that Tillerson called him a moron, or he might have told him that, and then he got out to the public, he like, yeah, well, we can take an IQ test. And ain't no doubt who going to pass, who going to get the highest score. You know, I'm going to get that. That sounds just like a moron, right? Always exalting themselves. It's always about them. You know what I'm saying? I tell you, boy. You know? And Trump would have called Kim Jong-un, a rocket man, he won't say he ain't got any sense. You follow what I'm saying? But see, we get the propaganda about Kim Jong-un. See, the deal about Kim Jong-un, them North Koreans, and this go all the way back to 1950, and you know, after the Korean War, we ain't letting you take us over. Now, you took over them southern ones down there, they'd sell out, but we ain't letting you take us over. See, we hooked up with China, we hooked up with Russia. You understand? We're going to fight you to the end. You got to just come and kill all of us because we're not giving in to your nonsense. Simple as that. And they the same way today. Now, you got many other nations standing up. Hey, that's over with. Okay? You understand? That's what Venezuela told them. Hey, you follow what I'm saying? They had the election and Maduro won, huh? And he like, hey, we ain't going for your nonsense, so we hooked up with China. Okay, we hooked up with China and Russia now. You understand? And anybody else that's against you. Now, but if you want to come get us, come get us. You're just going to have to kill us. Because like I was saying, you understand? I left off from that. You know, with Panama, you understand? In America, they brought the proposition to Torrio. You follow me? Who Noriega was, you know, one of his generals or majors or colonels or something, You understand? In that Panamanian army, and Noriega was the sellout. You follow me? And Torrijos, he wouldn't go for the game. He said, "No, man, I ain't doing this to my people." So they blew Torrijos up in the plane crash. I didn't talk about that before in the past. All those who, you know, plugged into y'all races. No, I mentioned this once before in the past. So they blew up, you understand, Torrijos in the plane. And then they put Noriega in there. But then after a few years, Noriega saw how scandalous they were. See, but he was like Saddam. You follow me? And he turned against them. They went and got him. They invaded Panama, got him and arrested him. Huh? Had him locked up all them years. They just sent him to France here the other year, and then he just died. I guess they didn't want him to die here. You follow what I'm saying? And who's to say he wasn't already dead? They just say he died over there. You follow what I'm saying? See? But, you know, just like they did you know, the one that they was supposed to be hunting, you understand, and Bhutto, you know, they you know, what's her name? Bhutto, you know, the president that got assassinated over there in was it Pakistan? As she came out, Benazir Bhutto came out and said that old boy, I can't think of his name. Nah, no, y'all, you know, they said they blamed 9/11 on, right? And they claimed that, you know, when Obama was president, they finally caught up with him and killed him. He was already dead. Okay, Benazir Bhutto, she revealed that in an interview with David Frost, that he had been killed, you know, that previous November. And this is some years back. This is a few years back. Okay? And then they ended up killing her shortly thereafter when she revealed that. Had her assassinated. You follow me? I can't think of his name. Now, I know some of y'all know what I'm talking about. I'm showing that fake picture of him on, you know, way back, and it wasn't him. There was some, you know, Hollywood actor that got made up like him, like he sent him a tape. I just can't think of his name. Now, you know, his family is hooked all up with the Bushes and whatnot over here. You understand? I'm telling you, I just can't remember his name. I know what I'm talking about. Somebody going to pop his name up on the screen and then I'll mention it in the Q&A. I just can't remember his name now. But y'all know what I'm talking about. You understand what I'm saying? His family was hooked up with the you know, the money credit, the Edomites, you know, way back. See? And they set him up, more likely than not. You follow what I'm saying? You can't get into bed with the snake. See? You can't get into bed with him. See? And these Iranians, just look at it. See? They coup Mossadegh when they had the elections back there in 50 over there in Iran. They cooled him just like they did Allende. Follow me in 70. You follow me? They cooled Mossadegh. And then they put the Shah in his place over there in Iran. And so they ran Iran for about 30 years. But when you get up there to 79, then the Iranians, you know, they had the revolution. And they knocked, ran the Shah up out of there. Huh? Captured the embassy, the United States embassy, which ain't, you know, the embassies ain't nothing but filled with spies. You follow what I'm saying? And held them hostage for what was it? Well over a year. Right? 400 something days. You follow me? And all that intrigue that went down, you know, when Reagan came into the White House and Oliver North and all of that. You understand what I mean? And them Iranians, they ain't been in the, since they kicked America out, they ain't been in the bed with America since. Because they know they snakes, and they said that back then. It's American government and these who running America. They know they snakes. Huh? See, so now, you follow what I'm saying? They can't just go get Iran, because Iran ain't never been in the bed. These Iran ain't never been in the bed with them. See, look at it. Look how America did the Shah when the Shah had to run from Iran. Huh? They didn't want him coming over here. See? Telling you, man, these some snakes. Marcos, they did the same way. Marcos was in the bed with them. They, Filipino people rose up and ran Marcos up out of there. Somoza, the Nicaraguans ran Somoza up out of there. He's an American puppet. See? Tell you, boy. See? So again, now, we witnessing the collapse of the daughter of America, the daughter of Babylon, and nothing can stop it. And Illuminati Edomite knows it. He knows we watching it. And he knows we talking about it. Ain't nothing he can do about it. Morning by morning. See, he wake up with it. Huh? carry it all through the day. Goes to bed with it night by night. Wake up with it the next morning because he see what's happening. God's allowing him to understand what's going on. Yeshua chapter 28, he can't stop it. His time has come. See, and Yah's repaying him to his face. At first, Yah's going to reveal him. He revealed it. See what I'm saying? Bring him out into the light so everybody can see who and what he is and what he's done and what he's doing. Systematically, Yah's doing this. And again, bringing these Edomites to their judgment. He repays everybody to their face. Chicago Tribune, October 11th. What expected? Yeah, y'all just don't answer that door. What expected move on Iranian deal means? Trump likely to take steps to unravel nuclear pact. Iran nuke cheap, don't undo deal. Trump likely to take steps to unravel nuclear pact, see? And Iran nuke cheap, don't undo deal. The head of Iran's nuclear agency warned the United States on Tuesday against undermining the 2015 nuclear deal, saying international non-proliferation efforts as well as Washington's international standing would suffer as a result. Okay, you hear that? See, Iranian nuclear chief Ali Akbar Salehi said Iran didn't want to see the deal unravel, but that much more is at stake for the entire international community than the national interests of Iran. See, he has a concern for the international community as well as Iran. But the other day, the Illuminati Edomite that runs America, he just want to have his way. Okay? He don't care about anybody. Don't care about the people here in America, huh? Don't care about the international community. He just want to have his way. See? Because they moving away from this dollar, which means the collapse of America. You can't be a world power anymore. It's over with. And they upset about it. Okay? Now, I know many of you heard Catalonia claims independence, but delays pursuit for dialogue. See, the Catalonians, they like want to move away from Spain. They want their independence. See? And Illuminati Edomite, he control, you know, more likely than not, it's the House of Rothschild that controls Spain. You follow me? You got these people, over 7 million people in Catalonia. They want to move away. They say, we're not getting a fair shake. So we want to declare independence. Okay, I said over 7 million. They say it's 2.3 million. At least that's what they say in this. But see, I done heard on one of those reports on RT, there's over 7 million people in Catalonia. See, this could be some more censorship. You know what I mean? Now, they do say that 2.3 million Catalans, okay, are 43% of the electorate in the northeastern region, okay? So it might still be over 7 million altogether. This is just the ones who, you know, part of the ones to vote. Okay, also, I know again, all of you mostly heard about this Edomite Weinstein, Hollywood, right? Like I said, you got a lot more women who have come out and accused him of raping them or molesting them or trying to. You know? Angelina Jolie, Gwyneth Paltrow, some of the important women in Hollywood, they've come out. Now, they've been knowing this for years, but they kept their mouth closed. Now, you know, it's coming out on them. All of it's coming out on it, what he's done and many others now. Okay? Also, black man beaten at the Virginia rally charged. So, many of you might have seen that what happened in Charlottesville, Virginia. And you might have saw that young brother named Harris. Okay, that was his last name. DeAndre Harris. He got beaten by these alt-right people. And these Nazi groups, they beat him up, and they showed a picture of beating him, you know, here's the picture, he was beating him, we saw it, many of you might have seen it. And now, you understand, he was charged. The prosecutors came back and charged him, okay, with the brawl. He's the one on the ground getting beat. And it's about a half a dozen, six, seven Caucasians beating him. I got the picture here, you can see it, if you can make it out. Okay, there it is, if you can make it out. He's the one on the ground, okay? And they beat him, but he got charged. Okay? Say the black man beaten in Charlottesville, Virginia parking garage by white supremacists after a Unite the Right rally has been charged with a crime in connection with the incident. Okay? Say even as police continue searching for some of the people who attacked him, but he got charged. Now figure that one out. You know, they chipped one of his teeth. I saw him talk about that. Say he was wounded. But he got charged. But you know, as we said before, any of us got any understanding, we shouldn't be marching about anything anyway, right? You remember chapter 29. Seek the peace of the city wherever you are. Pray to Yah for it. Huh? Do what's right in the sight of Yah and wait on Yah night and day to be brought to the to Jerusalem, to Israel, to serve Yah. Chicago Tribune, October 11th. Edomite or Israeli leader OK's plan for thousands of new settlements. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu approved building plans for 3,736 new units in Jewish settlements in the occupied West Bank on Tuesday. Okay? Yeah. Now check what Donald Trump said. President Donald Trump has said that settlements are not a good thing for peace, but announcements of plans to build thousands of new units since his inauguration have been met with limited rebuke. You know what I mean? He hasn't really put up no opposition toward these settlements. Okay? Because his son-in-law, Edomite, who gets counseled by Henry Kissinger every day or every other day, you know, he's one of his main proteges, you know, one of his main cabinet members, right? He's the one that he sent around all these countries, right? You understand? I tell you, boy. Yeah, boy. It's something. Chicago Sun-Times, October the 12th. U.S. wineries, their livelihoods, sports. Face long road ahead. Repercussions from still uncontained fires could last years. Okay? Here's another little side article. The Fed, Federal Reserve, is worried about inflation. Okay? But they're not telling you the real reason they're worried about inflation, because the dollar is being, you know, relegated to the value of Mexican peso. Quite naturally, they're not going to tell you that, you know, because of the yuan, the Chinese yuan. See? And possibly the other BRIC nations is going back, they paper with gold. You follow me? Also, Trump tax plan will help create a windfall. Yeah, for the rich. Okay? For the rich. Chicago Sun-Times, October the 12th, no fire respite forecast for California. 3,500 homes and businesses have been lost amid pure devastation. Chicago Sun-Times, October the 12th. VA conceals shoddy care, staff misdeeds, lax reporting, secret settlements allow problem health care workers to keep treating patients elsewhere after they get kicked out of the Veterans Administration Hospital and Services, right? Because they got some shoddy, you understand, health care workers in the VA. And they got a picture here of this Caucasian. She's in a wheelchair, missing her left leg. And it says, April Wood chose to have her left leg amputated after two surgeries at a VA hospital in Maine left her in excruciating pain. So she just had it, said, take it off. She couldn't take it anymore. Okay? She had two operations on her left leg at the VA, and she was in such horrible pain. She said, just cut it off. Okay? Now, this is the findings. In 2 years, internal records obtained by USA Today show the Department of Veterans Affairs spent nearly $6.7 million to secretly settle cases with problem employees, including medical professionals accused of negligence or misconduct who were allowed to resign with clean references. 126 cases in which the VA agreed to rescind firing orders and allowed employees to resign or retire instead. 82 cases in which the VA said it would purge negative records from workers' personal files. 75 employees who secured neutral references from the VA, hiding potential misconduct from future employers. 70 employees who agreed not to apply to VA hospitals for years or, in some cases, for life. And 38 cases that included confidentiality clauses barring disclosure of terms. VA has workers' past. Yeah. So that's what the veterans got to look forward to, who go over there and fight in these, you understand, these horrible wars that, you know, that the monster, the daughter of Babylon, sends them to attack these nations in various places, right? That's what veterans got to look forward to. They come back maimed and whatnot. Have any problem. And again, here in Chicago Sun-Times, October the 12th. You know, it's been a big revealment from the water department here in Chicago how it was racist all these years and how the climate, you know, was not only racist toward so-called African Americans, basically Israelites, right? It was also oppressive toward women of whatever their nationality. Okay? It's a troubled water. Alderman demands hearings on racist culture at city water department. And if you can make that out, that's the inside of a truck, a water reclamation truck. You see that noose hanging up there? See the noose? The hangman's noose? That was in one of the trucks there. That's how they do send signals to, you know, Israelites, so-called African Americans, right? Racist culture flows through it, okay, through the water department. This has been going on for years. This has come out. Okay, over the last month or so, it's come out, you know, all kind of videos, and tweets, you know what I'm saying, that have come out. It got some of these Caucasians who was headed to water reclamation fire. You know, Emmanuel, he might have to let them go, right? Because if he didn't let them go, it would have even been worse. But he had to let them go, you know. But that's been going on for years. But again, that's... What does it say? Thine a low stature, Ezekiel 17 chapter. Thine a low stature. Huh? And what does it say in Daniel chapter 2? Huh? You know, we shall mingle ourselves, huh? With the seed of men, but we shall not cleave one to another. Okay? Chicago Tribune, October 12th. Dangerous winds fueling California fires. I mean, you just look at this. these communities that all got burned out. Matter of fact, this is that's one of those what they call them cul-de-sacs. Look at that, huh? That's like 7 of those big, huge mansions all burned up around that cul-de-sac. Look like a bomb hit it, don't it? Huh? Those are big houses, man. You know, houses probably cost about $2-3 million a piece. Okay? They all burn up. They'll say it had 8,000 firefighters and other personnel battling the blaze. 170,000 acres. Man. Because the acreage keeps growing because the fires was going on for a while. I mean, a long time. They couldn't put them out. That's Yah. Okay, Chicago Tribune, October the 12th. Okay, allies designed to a Trump world. Many accept that things with the U.S. unlikely to improve. And they got representatives here from these different nations. See them there standing there with Trump? I tell you who it is. Okay, the European Council, President Donald Tusk, Britain's Theresa May, Trump. Also, right, Germany's Angela Merkel, Japan's Shinzo Abe, Canada's Justin Trudeau, France's Emmanuel Macron, European Commission President Jean-Claude Juncker, and Italy's Paolo Gentiloni. All right, and they saying things unlikely to improve in Trump world, okay? But Trump is not doing anything but carrying out his master's orders, huh? House of Rothschild's orders, right? And you know they know that, right? So they seeing how crazy Illuminati Edomite is, right? That House of Rothschild. Chicago Tribune, October 13th. Grim search for bodies as California fires toll at 31. Okay? That's as of October 13th. More, you know, it ended up being more. Right? Also, U.S. pulling out of UN agency. Israelis to follow. United States announced Thursday it is pulling out of the United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Agency because of what it sees as an anti-Israeli bias and a need for fundamental reform in the agency. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said that the Edomites plan to follow suit. Okay? Yeah. Okay. Palestinian rivals reach preliminary deal on governing Gaza. See, that's Hamas and Fatah. They're supposed to be getting together. Supposed to be. I'm wondering when they're going to realize they're descendants of Israel. I know some of them already have come to that. October the 13th, Chicago Tribune. Jobs Americans don't want. Unable to find enough U.S. workers, landscaper recruits Mexicans willing to travel far to do grueling work. Big article. Okay. Jobs Americans don't want. Now, that's why the wall Trump talking about building, he wants these men. Like I said, he probably got Mexicans working for him at these golf courses he own. You understand? And these hotels has got his name on it, because I don't think he owns these hotels. He's got his name on it. All right? He getting paid for using his name, right? Chicago Tribune, October 13th. Our toxic smartphone addiction. Okay? And then they got a picture here with all these people with a smartphone. Look at that. Huh? Okay? Because you can't hardly go anywhere without seeing people with a smartphone. or some kind of phone, I mean, you know. Said, guests captured the experience for Paris Fashion Week on their phones at a fashion show organized by cosmetics company L'Oreal on the Champs-Élysées this month. Our toxic smartphone addiction. Okay? Called it right, because that's what it is. Chicago Tribune, October 14th. 35 dead in California wildfires, many elderly, officials say. Huh? California declares an emergency over outbreak of hepatitis A. Okay? Got an outbreak of hepatitis A in California. Okay? Governor Jerry Brown declared a state of emergency because of hepatitis A outbreak that has killed 18 people. So they say, come on in and get your vaccination. Said they distributed 80,000 doses of the vaccine. But the officials say they need more to address the outbreak. Say hepatitis A is often transmitted through contaminated food. But California's outbreak is spreading from person to person. Chicago Tribune, October 15th. Thousands in Mexico still homeless, you know, after the earthquake, right? Weeks after quake, residents looking for places to live. Stuff everywhere, right? God's bringing forth his judgment. African nation on brink of civil war. Instability threatens bloodbath, genocide in Central African Republic. Okay, that's the Central African Republic. This is BRIA, B-R-I-A. So America's got troops down in there probably starting some mess, right? That's that CIA. What did Pompeo say? We're going to get vicious. The president is giving us, you understand, free reign. We're going to get vicious. Huh? A lot more vicious. That's what he's saying, right? So they doing everything, trying to keep America afloat, trying to sink their teeth in and get some economic input into this dead body. The body was on life support, but it's dead. They keep shooting it with what they call that, the insulin and whatnot, not insulin, but you know, they keep pumping the blood in it, trying to, you know, keep the heart pumping, but it's dead, it's comatose, you know what I mean? And they can't revive it because economically America's through. Okay? It's been on life support for years. Now it's through. Once China's doing what it's doing to them other nations, huh? And BRIC nations and whatnot, them nations gathering up around, you know, against it, it's through. Like I said, you look at that boom bust on IT yesterday. It's the UN, it's the Petro-UN now, not the Petro-Dollar, it's the Petro-UN. Okay? Chicago Tribune, October 15th. H-bomb cleanup troops sue for answers. U.S. denied their disability benefits after 1966 accident. Huh? You had the H-bomb that blew up over Spain. 1966, okay? You had a plane that was carrying four hydrogen bombs. Okay? And said, on a winter morning in 1966, nuclear weapons fell from the sky over southeastern Spain. High above, an American B-52 bomber on a Cold War alert mission had collided with a refueling plane in mid-flight. You hear that? okay, refueling plane and the B-52 collide. Okay, the impact blew open the aircraft's belly, sending 4 hydrogen bombs sailing toward Earth. 2 of the bombs partially detonated near the seaside town of Palomares, blasting craters as big as houses and coating the area in radioactive dust. Both aircraft were destroyed and 7 crew members were killed. The U.S. Air Force quietly assembled 1,600 low-ranking troops and rushed them to Palomares to clean up the mess. Among them was Anthony Maloney, then 21 years old, who arrived in the first wave. Said for weeks, Maloney and his counterparts toiled in the Spanish countryside, collecting wreckage, destroying crops, shoveling soil contaminated by the explosion. Some wore thin surgical masks, others had no protection. They ate local food, drank local water, and camped out in nearby tents until their work was done. Over the following decades, signs of radiation exposure manifested in many of the airmen. Everything from hair loss to blood disorders to cancer. But when they went to the Defense Department for help, they were systematically turned away. According to a new lawsuit by Maloney and 2 veteran groups. Big article. Okay? Big article. Follow what I'm saying? See that? Big article. Okay? Say the Defense Department never informed the majority of the airmen about their results and has resisted requests to do so, you know, in their investigation. See? Said other workers. Said the last stage of cleanup involved a massive excavation of contaminated soil. Said crews bulldozed the earth, sending clouds of plutonium-laced dust into the air. Other workers spent weeks shoveling tons of soil into barrels, which were eventually transported to the United States and buried. Radiation testing was performed hastily, according to the complaint. A medical team collected urine samples from airmen working at the crash site and conducted environmental testing, but the team had a hard time following laboratory protocols given the conditions on the ground. And the Defense Department never informed the majority of the airmen about their results and has resisted requests to do so. Okay? Say in 2013, the Air Force created a dose estimated methodology for the many airmen seeking benefits for what they claimed were Palomares-related disabilities. Most were told their radiation levels were too low to have triggered maladies, according to the complaint. Some were told there was no record of them having worked at the crash site at all. Okay, that's how American government does. It's loyal soldiers, right? In 1983, Scar developed, okay, let me go back up. Victor Scar was one of the men who was tasked with collecting urine from the troops working in Palomares. He was mentioned in the text of the veterans' lawsuit, but not named as a party. In 1983, Scar developed leukopenia, a reduction in white blood cells. Doctors said it was brought on by his exposure to plutonium. As he told the news leader in Springfield, Missouri last year, he has also fought skin cancer and prostate cancer. Okay, Scott told the news leader that the Department of Veterans Affairs had denied his medical claims because there was no record of him being exposed to radiation. Veterans my age are being ignored, he said, because, hell, we're going to die soon anyway. Okay? Now, that's how the government treats its loyal soldiers, right? Also, truck bombing kills 20, injures 15 in Somali capital. There's all kind of stuff going on in Somali. You know, America's hooked up. They got soldiers over there. All right? I'm telling you, look at that Democracy Now! Show when they're talking about Niger. You see this brother come on there. He's over there, and he was talking. He got an accident. He's going to save Niger, too, but he's running it down. And, you know, as a matter of fact, because he's on 2 shows. Well, 2 of them shows that was back-to-back that I just read off earlier on Democracy Now! Last month. Trump's speech sparks a new war of words between U.S. and Iran. Iran had changed deals, they can get that. Okay? Simple as that. And see, again, a lot of these, allies, they not going in with America against Iran because there's too much money involved for their country, their nation. Follow what I'm saying? Too much money involved. Hurricane death toll reaches 48 in Puerto Rico. Okay? Because it's a mess over there in Puerto Rico. Okay? And here's another article. Texas prisoners, inmates, donate $53,000 for Harvey release. Okay? Inmates serving time in Houston, Texas. Prisoners have also found a way to help those affected by Hurricane Harvey. Okay, the inmates donated more than $53,000 from their commissary funds to the American Red Cross to be used for hurricane relief. And the hurricane, affected people, they're not going to see a dime of that money. The Red Cross going to keep all of that. You know, the prison just trying to do something nice. They don't understand, though. Red Cross keeping all that money. The people who need it, they ain't going to see a dime of that money. I told you, that's what happened with the... The hurricane that hit Sandy, that hit New Jersey and all them places, a few years ago. Them people around that New Jersey, where was it? Right there around New York, it was right in New Jersey, I think it was that area there. I showed the picture. They said, Red Cross didn't do anything for them. And they've been donating money and having Red Cross drives for years. They said they wasn't going to get a Red Cross wasn't going to get another dime from them, another penny. So they didn't come to their aid at all, okay? See, I'm telling you. And then, I read the report here just not long ago, right, where it said that some people tried to investigate the Red Cross to see where all that money was going, what they did with the money, and they wouldn't let them, they had no transparency. They wouldn't let them know nothing about where the money goes, who it goes to, how much goes. They didn't let them know anything, see? Now, it was like I say, Red Cross, Rosicrucians, same thing, Rosicrucians, Red Cross, okay? Do some research, right? Okay, but also, while I'm thinking about it, RT reported this last week. And I know RT, because I haven't seen it in any newspaper, and I haven't heard about it on any other news show, right? But RT reported, they showed where, they got those people down there in Texas signing papers, okay, if they want to get some kind of help from FEMA, from this government, from being hurricane damaged, where they can't be hooked up, any business, any people down there, they can't be hooked up in the BDS, boycott, divestment, sanctions on them either, Mike. If they hooked up in that in any kind of way, they're not going to get any money from the government. Now, they got them down there signing these papers about that. Now, that came across IT last week. Okay? Now, those people down there in Texas, when they see this kind of paper, they're like, what? Huh? You understand? This might eventually come out even more for those of you who haven't heard. But they got people down there signing this kind of stuff. If you hooked up in that BDS, you can't expect any help from this government. Okay? Now, that's how crazy Esau is. You understand? You think that's going to endear many people to the Edomites' cause? It's going to have a reverse effect. You understand what I'm saying? Because they already giving them $3 to $4 billion tax money. You understand what I'm saying? And I know there's plenty of people, boy, when they see that, they're going to be hot. You understand? As they should be. At this government, and they're not going to have anything for the Edomites either. But that came across IT last week. That's why they want to shut IT down. Chicago Sun-Times, October the 16th. In Trump's mind, Puerto Ricans aren't Americans. Okay? This is a viewpoint from the Chicago Sun-Times. Like I said, I know many of you saw him throwing rolls of paper towel. You understand? To them, beat down and hurricane afflicted people in Puerto Rico, treating them just like, totally, you understand, in disregard and disdain at these people. You gonna stand there and throw them paper towels? I mean, how inhumane is that? How is that, so just non-concerned? But that's the pride, but that's the arrogance, right? I mean, you going down there, you at least show, some feelings, some compassion for them since you went down there. If you had that kind of mindset, you shouldn't even have gone. That, you've done yourself better not to even go. You should have sent an emissary down there. Huh? Told them you was too busy trying to stop this Iranian deal and what? Huh? You follow what I'm saying? You too busy with Rocket Man. You know what I'm saying? Chicago sometime again, October 16th, Somalia aghast after truck bomb kills hundreds. And America's hooked up in all this over in Somalia and Niger, like I say. I'm telling you, they all behind all this stuff. They all off, they got so many troops over there in Africa. See, they say about 6,000, but they don't really know. It reminds me of that movie, Clear and Present Danger. They got troops they done sent over there without the public's knowledge of it. See what I'm saying? And maybe many people in Congress with no knowledge of it. For those of you who saw the movie Clear and Present Danger with Harrison Ford. You follow what I'm saying? They doing all this clandestine stuff. See, and again, what makes me think that, for those of you who are privy, again, to Maisha Johnson, her husband, David that Johnson, got killed over there, right? And she said Trump had no compassion for her when he talked to her. And what was the key thing in what he said to her? And she put him on the speakerphone. It was in limbo that the government had sent for her. She had the Congresswoman Wilson in there with her, right? All of them heard him say it. And some of her family members. And he came on the speakerphone, and he's supposed to be trying to console her, but he told her, he knew what he was signing up for. So what does that sound like? Like I said, when I heard that, it made me think of that movie, Clear and Present Danger. Because they offer these soldiers, who they deem as a good soldier, They come calling in and say, we got some clandestine operation going down. You want to be part of it? You understand? And if you want to be part of it, if you agree, if you survive it, then you're going to get, promotion. You're going to get some privileges. You're going to get, some monies or whatever, something showered down on you if you survive it. All right, but the deal is, this is a clandestine operation. You might get killed, you understand what I mean? And then if you get killed, we might have to disavow, you understand what I mean, that we knew anything about it. You follow what I'm saying? Some Oliver North stuff, like what he was doing, you understand, in Nicaragua and with Iran and whatnot, okay? I'm telling you, that kind of stuff going on all the time. Like I said, like they cooled Mossadegh in Iran, like they cooled Allende in Chile, like they cooled Lumumba in the Congo. I mean, this kind of stuff going on all the time, right? Like they got rid of, blew up Torrio, put Noriega in there. See, all this clandestine stuff, all this secret stuff. See, you got to bring it out into the light, right? Chicago Sun-Times, October 16th. Now they got London police investigate new Weinstein allegations. Okay, you understand? Harvey Weinstein, that Edomite. He been molesting people and raping people and doing all kind of heinous stuff. You understand? British actors, American actors, he just crazy, okay? Totally out of his tree. And now y'all bringing it all out into the light. All these Edomites, everybody getting exposed, whoever you are, right? Also, I remember when Yada brought this to me, and then I saw the article. Antarctica penguin chicks wiped out. Now, this is out of Berlin. Almost the entire cohort of chicks from an elderly penguin colony in the eastern Antarctic was wiped out by starvation last summer. And what scientists say is only the second such incident in over 40 years. Researchers said Sunday the mass die-off occurred because unusually large amounts of sea ice forced penguin parents to travel farther in search of food for their young. By the time they returned, only 2 out of 1,000 of penguin chicks had survived. Okay? Man. Now, hey, when y'all told me this, and then I read this, and I was saying, you know what? What do you know? I know penguins got to play a part in y'all's ecology, but you know, just what part do they play? You know what I'm saying? What is their significance to y'all's whole ecological, you know, setup here? You follow me? What do they really contribute? Because I don't know. Maybe some of you out there know. Okay. Because they didn't say it. That I read you the old article. They didn't say that. Chicago Tribune, October 16th. 276 killed in Somalia bomb blast. Yeah, you know what I mean? I mean, it's just a mess over there. And I know U.S. got their hand in it. Okay? I know that. Okay? And they say Tillerson, right? This Tillerson, who called Trump a moron, say he was to stay with North Korea diplomacy until first bomb drop. He like, when the first bomb drop, then I'm out of here. Okay, but he's trying to be diplomatic, and Trump talking crazy, right? Like I said, you know, I was telling people, you know, if you remember those of you, when Trump, I think when he first, it's either when he first actually got into office or he had won the election, or should I say, he had won the selection, and he hadn't hit office yet, or he had just hit office, right? And the press was talking to him and said, well, you know, what's the deal with Russia? What you going to do with Russia? He said, well, we don't disclose. You remember that? He said, real calm, we don't disclose what we don't do. You know, we conference about it. We, you know, we counsel on it. And then, you know, we decide what's the best course of action, and then we just pursue it. We just do it. Huh? Now you fast forward, what? 9 months later, what did he send a message to Kim Jong-un? We'll drop fine fury. Okay, so what? What you changed, man? You was saying that you didn't tell people what you're going to do. You just did it right now. 9 months later, he's throwing all these wolf cookies out, right? That's what we used to call them back in the day, right? You putting out all this intimidation. We'll do this and we'll do that, right? Okay. And all them North Koreans is like, hey, do what you got to do, because we're going to do what we got to do. Now, because again, you know, I was telling some people, I saw on RT, they had this guy out of New York. He's a professor. Daniel Shaw was his name. And he was real kind. He was talking to the interview on RT. He said, the North Koreans, he said, you know, what have they done like to America? He said America went over there in 1950 and started bombing them, all the Koreans. You know, he said, and North Korea does not present a threat to America. You understand? He said all the North Koreans is saying, leave us alone. That's all they say, leave us alone. And when I heard that, I said, yeah, the Venezuelans is saying that. Huh? The Syrians is saying that. You know what I mean? The people of Yemen is saying that, huh? You follow what I'm saying? Because the people of Yemen, when the bombs, you know, that the Saudis is dropping on them and the whatnot, when they see the remnants of them bombs and whatnot, you know it's on there, right? Made in USA. See? The Afghanis is saying that, leave us alone, huh? The Iraqis is saying that, leave us alone. The Libyans is saying that, leave us alone. Follow me. South American nations, you see what yesterday this Illuminati Edomite of the West, this House of Rothschild has done to his monster, the United States of America, through the years. And again, like I said, some of them other Illuminati members was hooked up with them at first, but now it's enmity between them. They you know, they falling out. See, but because they did all this stuff through the monster, their monster, Dr. Frankenstein, you follow what I'm saying? America, huh? These nations is upset with America. You follow me? See, and where Russia might have done something to them, or China might have done something to them, it ain't nowhere near like what America's done to them. So now, you know, China, Russia, you know, the other Illuminati members, they open up their arms and say, come on over here to us. Because he done went crazy. You know, we can't deal with it. You know what I'm saying? So that's prophecy coming to pass right before our eyes. It should be against the daughter of Babylon round about. You read me chapter 5. Chicago Tribune, October the 18th. Deadly fires ease. Anger grows over Iberia's 45 fire deaths. Now, this is in Lisbon, Portugal. This is in Portugal. They had fire. 45 dead. Okay? 45. And that's in Portugal. See? All right. And right next to that little bitty article, they got a picture of Boulder Creek, California, and the firefighters fighting the fire in Boulder Creek, California. Now, you tell me if this ain't the Most High. He works through people and he works himself. You understand? The lightning, the fire dropping from the sky, that's him, right? And he works through people too, right? It's all, yeah. By his spirit. Chicago Tribune, October the 19th. Going cashless, a bad ship for shops. Now check this out. Okay? I'll tell you, boy. I'll tell you, this is something else. Now just listen to this. Okay? Going cashless, a bad shift for shops. Local restaurants and shops that go cashless and take only customer credit or debit cards have no currency, with a powerful Chicago alderman who wants to stop the growing payment trend in its tracks. Many of you out there, you've heard me mention this Alderman Edward Burke here. I told you he's the most powerful alderman in this city. Been that for years. He's the finance chairman. He run all the money for Chicago. Okay, whatever kind of contracts, whatnot, money gets dispersed, it comes through Ed Burke. Okay? All right? Irish. Okay? Alderman Ed Burke, 14th chairman of the City Council Finance Committee. You understand? Recently introduced an ordinance that would not allow Chicago stores and eateries to be cashless. You hear that? See, this is what these are trying to bring down. See, but Burke don't want that because, see, people he hooked up with that own these businesses here in Chicago, they're like, hey, man, this is hurting our business. You understand? We don't want to go cashless. Now, check this out. It says the ordinance also chides electronic payment giant Visa International for aggressively encouraging businesses to stop taking greenbacks and accept only plastic. Now, this is being pushed by Visa, okay? And you know who Visa is. That's Chase, Manhattan Bank. You dig? You know, Morgan Chase. That's them. That's the banker, right? Okay, now check this out. Burke's proposed law, which has been sent to a council committee, could end up being a legislative trial balloon that floats into obscurity. Nevertheless, it raises a thorny but important question. Do cashless businesses discriminate against consumers who don't have bank accounts or credit cards or just prefer to use coins and bills? While alternative payments are here to stay, basic service industries, places where everyday folks can shop for necessities and dine, still have an obligation to be inclusionary and accessible to everyone. Going cashless prevents that from happening, which is why the idea should be voluntarily shelved before any government crackdown gains momentum. And remember this, any of these businesses that take a credit card, they got to pay a fee on that credit card for you using it. They pay a fee. You follow me? That was another reason why they don't want it. It's like, you heard none. You understand what I'm saying? See? Now, what do poor people do when they don't have access to credit or debit and can't use a book? Burke asked, meanwhile discussing the ordinance, which is co-sponsored by 27th Ward Alderman Walter Burnett Jr. That's one of us. Walter Burnett Jr., he one of us. Okay, he the one that said a few months ago, I read article, you understand, when he made the mention to it about Emmanuel, you know, they was brothers, you know what I'm saying? They like, you understand, of the same tribe, Burnett. I can't remember exactly, but that's what he innovated. You know, like he know he Israel. You know, where he thinking he a Jew too, like Emmanuel. He made reference to that. So Burnett is in with Burke about this. You follow me? See?
That's how Bert, you know what Bert did. He pulled Burnett's coat. I want you to sign on with this. And Burnett, okay, boss. You understand what I'm saying? Okay? Now, check this out. That is an uncomfortable question facing business operators. Now, Bert claimed he concerned about the poor, but he really not. He concerned about his business associates who own these businesses. They don't want to all nothing but credit cards and debit cards coming in that they got to pay a fee on. Plus, it's going to stop people who got cash. You follow what I'm saying? Who want to deal with cash? You understand? And put the bank in all their business. You understand? Because once you use that plastic, the bank in all your business. They don't want that. And that's who Burke. You know, he ain't going to say it like that. You understand what I'm saying? He going to make reference to the poor. But poor, the actual poor, is not going into these restaurants and whatnot that Burke represents. Because I'm talking about these high-powered restaurants and businesses, eateries and whatnot, and businesses that do business here in this city. He hooked up with the high power. You understand what I'm saying? So he ain't concerned about the poor, because poor is not even patronizing in places. Some of them places, you understand, I can tell you for a fact, from first-hand experience, you go there, they look at you, we don't have no seating for you. And they basically tell you that we all booked up. You understand what I'm saying? That happened to me many years ago. Okay, when I went to one of these high-powered restaurants, we don't have no reservations. I mean, you know what I mean? We don't have no open seat. You understand? So that's who Burke concerned with. Now, check this out. It says some statistics. In Illinois, 7.1% of Illinois households do not have bank accounts, which is a bit higher than the national average, according to the Federal Deposit Insurance, you know, FDIC, right? Around 37% of the unbanked make less than $30,000 annually, and groups without banking services include high percentages of people with disabilities, minorities, and those under 34 years old. Concern over access to restaurants, stores, and other shops prompted Massachusetts in 1978 to pass a discrimination against cash buyer law that prevents retail establishments from going cashless. Now, this is what they passed in 1978 in Massachusetts. So what's that tell you? That tell you that Esau, the banker, you understand, they was moving, trying to move it toward that in 1978. Massachusetts, no, they passed the law. You understand, there ain't going to be none of that up in here. All right? Now, check this out. Lately, that law, which was cited in Burke's ordinance, has been tested, but it's still holding up. The alderman also takes credit card giant Visa to task for its Visa cashless challenge, an incentive program that offers $500,000 to 50 eligible companies nationwide that commit to what the San Francisco-based company labels a cashless quest. The ordinance claims the program is proof that going cashless is not pro-consumer, but a sop to credit card companies that profit. Okay, wait a minute. Okay, that profit from retailers' transaction fees. Visa didn't know anything about the proposal Chicago law until I gave the company a call. In a statement, it stressed the Visa challenge does not require stores to stop using cash. We do, however, hope merchants and consumers increasingly see the value in using less cash and embracing a digital future. You hear that? Did you hear that? I'm going to read that again because I want all of y'all to hear that. Okay? Now, listen well. We do have, now this is Visa, okay? Based in San Francisco, right? We do, however, hope merchants and consumers increasingly see the value in using less cash and embracing a digital future, the statement added. Now, you know that's Bitcoin, right? And plastic, huh? And debit cards. Credit cards. That's what they want. That's why China and Russia, they like, hey, you don't bring no Bitcoin over here. Don't bring that electronic currency nonsense over here. We understand? You understand? We ain't drinking that Kool-Aid. Now, okay? Now, that's what they pushing. Because, see, again, with the Petro-UN and the UN backed by gold, that's why they're not reporting that over here. The only way you find that out, like I said, you get this alternative news like RT. That's why they want to shut RT down. You follow what I'm saying? Or you go to this internet, you might pick it up some of this alternative news that's coming across the internet. But they not talking about it here because they trying to push this toward a cashless society because the dollar's collapsing right before our eyes. You follow what I'm saying? It's collapsing. And so they want to move everybody here and everybody outside of here, if they can, into Bitcoin, into digital coin, or into plastic, some form of plastic. You follow me? That's why the Russians and the Chinese and those of them BRIC nations don't bring that nonsense. We ain't going into that. See? Because if you listen about this Bitcoin, electronic currency, it's nothing but an investment, just like these stocks and bonds. I said that on the last session when I talked about it. I read some about it because I kind of remember I did. It's nothing but an investment. It's just like stocks and bonds. They can, you know, they can manipulate it like they do. That's why they're driving the price of it up now. You follow what I'm saying? All manipulation. See, but you can't do that with gold and silver. Can't do that. You got to be honest. See, and that's why these Russians and Chinese, and you got other ones, they're like, hey, don't bring that nonsense over here. Okay? See, now that's what's going down. All right? Now check this. I want to read this. For some, reducing or not using debit and credit cards is one way to discipline personal spending. There's nothing like forking over a chunk of change to remind us how much everything costs. See? Not that long ago, many gas stations offered discounts at the pump when drivers paid in cash, while retailers, many of whom don't like hefty transaction fees. See that? They got to pay those transaction fees. Right? So they often discourage customers from using credit cards. Most important, even in this era of the exotic Bitcoin and other alternative financing options, the dollar remains the legal coin of this realm. See, yes, then they got to take it if you got paper. See, but this is what they're attacking. This is what they don't want. You follow me? So they're trying to move you into Bitcoin. And they got the Max Kaisers and the Reggie Middleton and these boobs out here, you know, these sellouts. Pushing Bitcoin. That's the deal. But you know, you understand, like I said, you understand, if you see that, bring up that Chris Whalen and Max Kaiser that was on yesterday on Max Kaiser's show, huh? October 31st, Chris Whalen, he'd been on there before. Pay particular attention when Kaiser's interviewing Whalen and what Whalen said. You understand? He said, yeah, you know, they got these bits of Bitcoin out here, these, you understand, that you in. These patches of Bitcoin, he mocked it, you know, but Kaiser didn't deal with that at all. He just went right past that. Cause he know Whalen's hip to it. So he didn't want Whalen to keep on talking about that. Cause Whalen was exposing it. Just like Peter Schiff, just like Stephen King, just like Gerald Celente. Huh? You follow what I'm saying? They know all this Bitcoin is a bunch of nonsense. Okay? Okay, also Michael Pinto. He was on Kyle the other week. Michael Pinto, he know that Bitcoin is a bunch of nonsense. See? Now, they want to go to a cashless society. That's what they want. Because they can blow that up and pump that up just like they've been doing this paper. And Whalen touched on that yesterday in the interview with Kyle. Because he said when they took the gold backing, you understand? When the FDI came in there and they confiscated everybody's gold that they could and made everybody deal with paper. In other words, we're not taking no gold. That was in 33, right? 34. All right, now, you understand? When you get to 1971, all this 1971 and Nixon, you understand? They took the gold back from the dollar. You understand? In Nixon's watch, August 1971. And that's when it became the petrol dollar. Because they like, you can't buy oil unless you use the dollar. That's what kept the dollar in play. But see, when they took that real backing, that gold backing, and silver backing from this money, you understand? Because they took the silver backing back in the late 60s. When they did that, like Whalen said, then they could just blow it up as much as they want. All they can do is just print money. Just print paper. Just print paper. It ain't backed by anything, so you have no restriction now. No boundary. Just blow it up. And he said, that's how all this inflation, that's how all this debt came about. See? You follow me? And that's what they want to do now with this digital currency. You understand? They try to play it like they not for it, but they the ones behind it. And that article just exposed it totally. You understand? Visa, again. You understand? Chase Morgan Bank. Now, you understand what I'm saying? That's them. That's Bitcoin ain't nothing but game. So don't drink the Kool-Aid. Okay? See, and that also pulls the covers off Max Kaiser. Like, he say some good stuff. Like, I keep telling all of y'all, you got to discern all this stuff. You got to discern it. You got to trust in y'all, with all your heart and soul. You got to obey y'all with all your heart and soul. And then you got to discern this stuff. And y'all will, as long as you acknowledge y'all in all thy ways, he will direct that path. See, because those of us who bow y'all, I don't care if you Israel, Hamite, Shemite, or Yethite. You dig what I'm saying? If you are serving Yah and following him, what does Yah say? Envy not the oppressor, choose none of his ways. 331 Proverbs, right? You follow me? You read me chapter 10, right? Learn not the ways of the heathen, for the customs of the people are what? Vain. Okay, so at one time, we were all plugged in per se to the ways of the heathen. But now once you turn to Yah, or once you get directed to Yah, isn't that what you see in Yeshua chapter 30? You're going to hear a voice behind you saying, this is the right way, walk in it. Turn to Yah. Isn't that what you see in Malachi chapter 4? Right? And Yah going to raise up his servant, this seed of David, this stone cut out without hands. And he going to do the same thing that Eliah did back there in the time of Eliah. He goes, how long you going to halt between these two different, you understand, ideology? You understand what I'm saying? If Yah is the Most High servant, if Baal or the Baal of today, which is Jesus, this Yahushua, you understand, of the New Testament, if he's the creator, then serve him. But stop saying that you serving Yah or you're serving the creator, the Father, and this Jesus, Yeshua, is his son. Stop saying that, because that's not true. It's not but one. It's not but one. What does Yah say in Deuteronomy 32:39? I wound, I kill, I heal, I make alive, and there is no strange idol God with me. It's just me. Huh? Over there in Zechariah chapter 14. This is in some other places too, but over in 14, Zechariah. At the end of the last battle, what does Yah say? His name gonna be one, he gonna be one in all the earth. Okay. Malachi 3:6. Yah don't change. So if he gonna be one at the end, he had to be one at the beginning. And all the way through. So where are these people getting two? Or three? Or what else? Other than one. The one is Yah. Period. See? So we acknowledge his laws, statutes, orders, judgments, precepts, huh? And you understand? And statutes and orders in all our ways. Before we do anything, we run it through that, huh? Through the law. If it falls, whatever it is, if it falls outside the law, we can't do it. Real simple, right? Huh? That's your Remy 31:31. Huh? You understand? Gonna do a new thing. Not everybody got to read. Everybody got to study. Everybody got to pray. Everybody's got to do the law. Everybody's required to read this book of remembrance, this so-called Old Testament, Genesis through Malachi, in its entirety, and study it. Learn it. Because it's near everybody. That's the new covenant. Okay, I ain't asked nobody to believe me. You follow me? I ain't asked nobody to follow me. Right? What have I said? You, none of you out there, just go through the website. You never heard me say believe me. You ain't never heard me say follow me. Right? What have I said? Read, study, pray, and do. Read, study, pray, and do. Read, study, pray, and do. That's been the message from day one since this popped up into the view of the people. Go back there to the first show we did with Mark Sims. Pay particular attention to what I said. You got to read. You're not going to get this law just walking around all of a sudden, poof, the magic dragon is going to be on your heart and on your inward part. You got to apply yourself. Chicago Sun-Times, October 21st. Pollution, world's number one killer, a threat to mankind. I don't have to say any more, do I? I'm going to show you the headline and the picture. You follow? You see it? Pollution, world's number one killer, a threat to mankind. Okay? They say, Rosina Hill, the government seat of power in New Delhi, is engulfed in morning smog Friday. India leads the world in pollution-related deaths.
almost a quarter of all deaths in the country are from pollution. You see that pollution? You can see it look like a fog. It is a fog, but it, you know, it is pollution. That's in New Delhi. Okay? You understand? I tell you, boy, that's messed up. That's over in India. Because they over there, you know, got the smokestack industry, you know, just like China, just like here, right? And other industrial places. They using coal, they using, you understand, fossil fuels, smokestack industry. See, that's again why Daniel chapter 2, what did y'all say? When that stone hits, huh? When it hits that image of them four kingdoms of man, right? And they started to break up and crumble up, that stone starts to grow. And them four images started to break up and crumble up. All the way from that head of gold, all the way down through them feet and toes, part iron, part clay. The silver, huh? The brass, right? The clay, everything that's hooked in with them four kingdoms. All the concepts that have been conceived of, all the inventions that have come about, all those got to go out with them four kings. See? There go Christianity. There go Islam. There go smokestack industry. There go combustible engines. Huh? There go diesel engines. You follow what I'm saying? There go the TV, as we know it. There go the radios. You understand? The cell phones with all this bauxite and stuff in it that you understand? Microwave, all that's going out. We don't know what y'all got in store in his kingdom. See, now you get one of these fools out here, they say, man, he talk about we going back to the Stone Age, and it never was no real Stone Age anyway. You understand what I'm saying? But that's how the fool will talk. See, but y'all has not revealed to us what is going to be in his kingdom and how he going to do it. Now, you know, man can't do it nowhere near what y'all going to do. You understand what I'm saying? We got to wait for y'all to reveal that what's going to be in his kingdom. That's what I was telling the doc in the optical office, you know, when I went to get the glass, who gave me the eye test, and we got to talk. You understand? This Caucasian. You understand? And he could hear it well. He was sitting there smiling when I was hitting him with it. You follow what I'm saying? We don't know what y'all got. And that's just how I was telling him. We don't know what y'all got in store. See, man can only see out of his eye. You follow what I'm saying? I said, and I told him, I said, because the average person, they would think, man, he's going back to the Stone Age. He was kind of laughing what I said. You know what I mean? He was smiling, listening. I said, hey, but y'all got something in store. And he picked up on it. He said, yeah. He said, you know, he might have this stuff running off something that's good. I said, absolutely correct, Doc. He picked up on it immediately. Now, you follow what I'm saying? He probably even had these thoughts before he met me, before we even talked. You follow what I'm saying? I'm telling you, man, it's, you know, but you get these people who, you know, can't see, got this nonsense all in their heart. They can't, you know what I mean? They looking really backwards. You follow what I'm saying? They can't visualize. See? But y'all say they know not the works of my hands, huh? Chicago Sun-Times, October 21st. Cost of 2017 hurricanes, this is what I mentioned earlier, right? Earthquakes about $95 billion. Okay, that's from the hurricanes and the earthquakes so far this year. The cost, about $95 billion. Whew. And they say that's what's going to cost the insurance industry. That's why that article I read last said, see, all premiums is going up. Okay, whatever kind of insurance you got, your premium going up. Because you understand they're going to soak the people. They're going to hit the people for trying to make up this difference here. All right, now, see, okay, also, Bitcoin hits record as it surges above 6,000, see, and that's gain, you understand, just like the Dow, huh, and the S&P, yeah, you understand what I mean, the NASDAQ, all the Esau manipulating all of that, trying to lure the suckers into it, and so he trying to lure whatever suckers, you know, the blind, the lame, the, you know, the prey, he can suck into this trap of Bitcoin, electronic currency. So don't drink the Kool-Aid. Chicago Tribune, October 21st. Somali death toll rises to 358. This country plans state of war. See, you tell me CIA, ISIA, you know what I mean? You tell me they not over there. Okay, I'm telling you, ain't nothing but a game. Just like I know
This is November 1st. Know all y'all heard what happened yesterday in Manhattan, right? You understand what I mean? And the guy that, you know, took the truck, went down the bike path in Lower Manhattan on the west side down there where the Trade Centers used to be, where the Trade Center Memorial is, right? And ran over so many people, hurt about 8 or 9 people, killed about 8 or 9. Matter of fact, he killed 8 so far and hurt about 8 or 9 more. Okay? Matter of fact, 11, I think, well, he hurt like 11. Some of them might die. Yes, then before they shot him, he ain't dead. Okay, he got out, he supposed to have a pellet gun and something else. He didn't have no real gun when he jumped out the truck. So now what is he, a Manchurian candidate? But they put one of those, you understand what they call, you know, up under the skin, in his arm or in his head, you know, one of them, devices in his head up under his skin or something, and clicked it, sent him a message, and he just went crazy. I'm telling you, you might be out there laughing at what I'm saying, but this is what's going on. Manchurian candidate. Okay, now, you follow me? Don't let them put nothing up under your skin. Don't let them put no device, no electronic device in you. You know what I'm saying? And I know, you know, as I read that article the other month, right, some of these people, they doing it on these jobs. When they tell them, we gonna put the, you understand, I forget, it's escaping me now, the little device up under your skin, right? So the chip, right? We're gonna put the chip in your hand, in your wrist, or behind your ear, and if you that's, you ain't gonna have to, you just then check in no more. You ain't gonna have to have no plastic card to check in at the job. And if you don't want this, we're gonna have to let you go. So plenty of them go, oh no, because they got a $50,000, $40,000, $60,000, $70,000 a year job. It's all right, because they don't want to let that job go. So they gonna go on and go for it. You follow what I'm saying? Like I said, that article I just read. That Alderman Burke, I'm telling you what time it is with him. He hooked up with these big businesses around here. They don't want that. But they got to pay a fee. They're going to make less money. So he coming out on their behalf. And he going up against, the bankers. You follow what I'm saying? Because look here. You know Emmanuel, the Edomite mayor here, he's hooked up with the bankers. He know about this. You didn't see him in there co-signing none of this in that article, right? We understand Burke went and got one of us. Walter Burnett, you understand, and told him he wanted him to go in with him, and he, okay, boss, I'll go in with you. You follow what I'm saying? But you didn't see Emmanuel saying anything, because he going to push this too, because he's in with the banker. They the ones who made him mayor. See? And don't think Burke don't know that. You understand? Okay? Also, 140 arrested in Malawi after mob attacks on vampires. Now, this is out of Lilongwe, Lilongwe, Malawi. Mob attacks on people suspected to be vampires have led to 140 arrests in Malawi, police said Friday. More arrests were expected. 9 people have been killed in the attacks that began last month after rumors of bloodsuckers spread. In the latest case, a man with epilepsy was burned to death in Blantyre, the Southern African nation's second largest city, said Lexon Kokama, the Inspector General of Police. President Peter Mutharika has appealed for calm in the 4 districts where the attacks have taken place. The UN and U.S. Embassy have called the areas dangerous for staffers. Health officials, teachers, and traditional leaders have said their homes were destroyed after rumors spread they were harboring vampires. Come on. You know what I'm saying? Now, again, you understand? Are these the people that's, trying to take people's monetary wealth and they call them vampires that way? Is that how it got over here? Or people really trying to act like they, trying to really suck the literal blood out of a person. Come on. We might be just getting it filtered. Okay? All right, in Chicago Sun-Times, October 22nd. Chicago Satanist. There's no devil. Humans are our own God. Okay? And that's this G. Edwin Taylor, a warlock in the Church of Satan. first read the Satanic Bible as a teen and thought, damn, this is me, points out that despite the name, his group doesn't worship the devil. Indeed, its members are atheists who use Satan as a symbol they believe represents pride, liberty, and individuality. Now, that's him there. He think he a warlock. Okay? You understand? Now, you see the symbol around his neck, right? Five-pointed star, right? I tell you, boy, you got all kinds of stuff going on, huh? Whew. Total off the chain. Okay, Chicago Tribune, October 22nd. Storms, swamp, feds, flood insurance. You hear that? Costly hurricanes raise tough questions about the future of the indebted program. Okay, an unprecedented wave of destructive hurricanes has brought the long, struggling federal flood insurance program to the brink. You know what that means, brink of collapse. Now Congress faces tough questions about whether to again bail out the nearly 50-year-old program and how to implement reforms to make it more sustainable, secure, and cost-effective. Okay. You understand? I just read to you where they say it's going to buy $95 billion of damage with the hurricanes and the earthquakes. Okay. They going back to Hurricane Katrina, which was in 2005, the year after the flyer went out, to the monarchies and some of these other, you understand, Israelite movements and whatnot. You understand? And then in 2005, it went all the way up to, it was on Capitol Hill. And the Hurricane Katrina wasn't until late on that year. Because we sent up there to Bush and all them up there on Capitol Hill in the early part of 2005. The Katrina was late on. Okay? So similar, you know, you had one or two, you had another hurricane, I think, latter part of 05 or 06, top of 06, something like that. Right? Then I just communicated to send it out again, and then you get unprecedented hurricanes and earthquakes and fire. Right? Behind the sending out of the fly this last time. Okay? They got a picture here. Five former presidents take stage at relief concert in Harlan, Texas. And they got Jimmy Carter, old man Bush, Clinton, and Obama. And they all standing there together. Because they all in the same club anyway, pointed by the Illuminati Edomite. House of Rothschild. Now look at that. Now that's Texas. That's Houston. Swamped in war. Okay? Swamped in war. That's from Harvey in August. Chicago Tribune, October 22nd. Need a more evolved Bible museum. $500 million DC gallery aims to let public decide, not preach. Now, you understand what I'm saying? So they trying to offset this message again. You understand what I'm saying? Now check this out. The Museum of the Bible, a massive new institution opening next month just south of the National Mall, is just as notable for what it includes. Vivid walkthrough recreations of the ancient world, one of the world's largest private collections of Torahs, a motion ride that sprays water at you, a garden of biblical plants, as for what it leaves out. Okay? $500 million museum chaired and largely funded by the conservative Christian family that owns Hobby Lobby doesn't actually say a word about the Bible's views on sexuality or contraception. The museum doesn't encourage visitors to take the Bible literally, okay, or to believe that the Bible has only one correct form. And in floor after gleaming floor of exhibit, exhibit, No, wait. And in floor, after gleaming floor, I think that they made a mistake, but nevertheless, of exhibitions, there's very little Jesus. You hear that? I'm going to read that again. And in floor, after gleaming floor, oh, okay, I got it now. You know, in other words, it's levels, right? And in floor, after gleaming floor of exhibitions, there's very little Jesus. You hear that? Okay, now I got another spot over here, because, you know. It says, the museum could quick, no, not that same, but some, okay, let me go back. The museum could quickly become a popular draw for evangelical families, about a quarter of the U.S. population, where the Bible is daily reading in many homes. In a 2014 Pew Research Center poll, 45% of Americans said they seldom or never read Scripture, but 63% of evangelicals said they read it at least once a week. But some conservative evangelicals might be frustrated with parts of the museum, both in what it is and isn't there. This museum doesn't try to prove the historical veracity of the Bible or argue that the earth is about 6,000 years old, like the Creation Museum in Kentucky. It devotes a display to the Virgin Mary, a biblical figure whom evangelicals believe has been elevated too highly by Catholics. Jesus is also curiously not central to the museum's presentation of the biblical story. Visitors walk through a multi-room saga of the Old Testament and can visit a recreation of the first century village in Galilee, where actors will tell them what the villagers think of this controversial preacher, Jesus. They can watch a movie about John the Baptist, but the story of Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection is almost absent. Yeah. You know, because they know that that's game showing up. I mean, you know, but they just trying to, you know, keep the people still confused. $500 million, $500 million for this, right? Okay, that's how Esau knows that this message is resonating and people are waking up and people are turning to the book on their own and really starting to read it, you understand what I mean? And they can see this Jesus is a bunch of nonsense, okay? And this message is coming out of Yah righteous for sure is resonating, okay? Now, and they see that, so they're going to spend a half a billion trying, and they're doing other stuff, trying to debug it, you know, trying to turn people around. Okay. Also, 50 plus Egyptian police killed in ambush. This is out of Cairo. They had 54 Egyptian police were ambushed and killed. Okay, over in southwest of Cairo. Okay, yeah. So I'm telling who behind that. You know, because the Egyptians, you know, they all in the bed with Esau, huh? A base nation now. Base. It's like y'all said they would be. For all those Egyptian lovers out there, of Israel and anybody else, who think Egypt was so great a nation. You understand? Just like y'all said it was going to end up being base. Chicago Tribune, October 22nd. Kidney for sale in Iran, and it's this organ harvesting. Like I said earlier, you know, it was on Boom Bust the other day on RT. You got about 34 companies operating out of America that harvest organs, and they sell them all for, you know, these different organs for different prices. Okay? Body snatches. Okay, said country has legal market for the organs, but system doesn't always work. Okay, and this Ali Razi, 42, stands beside the ad he placed for his kidney outside the Hamashinijai Kidney Center in Tehran. Iran is the only country that allows kidneys to be sold. He said, if I could sell my kidney, I could get out of debt. That's something. That's people in such debt, they want to sell their own body part to get out of debt. Said, in fact, he said, if I could sell my kidney, I could get out of debt. That's what Ali Razi, bankrupt, 42-year-old air conditioning installer, said in the shade of a tree across from the kidney hospital. I would sell my liver too. You hear that? Now, how you gonna live? You ain't got a liver. Okay? Said, in fact, Iran offers people a legal way to sell their kidneys and is the only country in the world to do so. A government foundation registers buyers and sellers, matches them up, and sets a fixed price of $4,600 per organ. Since 1993, doctors in Iran have performed more than 30,000 kidney transplants this way. I tell you, man, they become like you know, Esau, Dr. Frankenstein. I tell you, this thing is crazy. People is just crazy. All these idolaters. Woo, man. Chicago Sun-Times, October 23rd. Record heat. Santa Ana winds ratchet up California fire threat. Los Angeles to pass 100 degree mark this week. It's been hot in southern, you know, in LA and in California. It's been super hot. Okay. Says as of Sunday, 6,000 firefighters continued their efforts to contain 10 active wildfires that were still burning. Says since the fire siege began October 8th. At least 42 people have died, and an estimated 8,400 structures have been destroyed. About 245,000 acres have burned, an area that's larger than all of New York City's five boroughs combined. The estimated cost is at least $1 billion. At the peak of the fires, 100,000 people were forced to flee their homes. And you see that person, he got his face all covered because he's trying not to breathe in all them cinders and whatnot from the fire. Look at the smoke all in the air. It's a mess. But again, that's all because of what they're doing. You know, I mean, people in steeped in idolatry, y'all bringing judgment. So Chicago Sun-Times, October 23rd, as many as 4 tornadoes hit southwest Oklahoma. Okay. It's 4, okay? Man. Man, I tell you. Chicago Tribune, October 23rd. Are you prepared to live with the risk? Okay? If you want to live in California, you have to be prepared for fires, earthquakes, and mudslides. If you want to live on the Gulf Coast in Florida, the Atlantic Coast, or the U.S. islands, you have to be prepared for hurricanes, floods, and sinkholes. If you want to live in the central part of the country, you have to be prepared for tornadoes, along rivers, floods. Be sure you are fully insured in any case, wherever you are. I already live on the edge of disaster and cannot afford to keep subsidizing your lifestyle while having none of my own. And that's what this person in Crest Hill right here outside Chicago wrote. You know what I mean? Because they know their insurance is steadily going up and up and up, and they say they're subsidizing for all these people who catching problems. He said, you living in these places, then you got to be prepared for that. I can't afford to keep subsidizing to get you out of this when you live. Don't go live in these places. But, you know, yes, that'll be. I tell you, man, they don't realize what's going on. Okay, look at this. That's fire devastated. Look at that. Look like a bomb been dropped. Okay. Chicago Tribune, October 24th. They got a picture of these Edomites, security forces trying to remove ultra-Orthodox Edomite Jews blocking a road Monday in Jerusalem during a demonstration against new procedures enacted by the government to receive exemptions from conscription into the military. These Edomites don't want to go in the military, so they all looking at, they all sitting in the rows. You understand? Because they being conscripted to go into the military. And they're like, I'm exempted. I'm going to be a priest. You know what I'm saying? Okay. I tell you, boy, this thing is something else. Something else. Being exposed. Everything and everybody. Chicago Sun-Times, October 25th. Jeff Flake just says no to the new GOP. Conservative senator won't seek re-election. That's the one who sent the flyer back. He the only senator congressman that sent the flyer back. Unopened. Jeff Flake. Okay, so what does he know? Like I said, he might be an Edomite. Matter of fact, with a name like Flake, you understand? I think that's what he is. Okay, also, still near shutdown 5 weeks after hurricane. Puerto Rico, okay? Paralyzed. 5 weeks after hurricane, they still shut down. Okay? It's Puerto Rico messed up. And you got the vultures. That's what they were saying about that whitefish and them electrical contract. The vultures trying to come in and make money off of them. You follow me? Chicago Sun-Times, October 25th, retiring senators rip Trump in GOP civil war. That's Senator Bob Corker of Tennessee and Senator Jeff Flake of Arizona. They don't have anything for Trump at all. And in so doing, they really against the Illuminati Edomite, right? House of Rothschild, right? They probably know that. Okay, Chicago Tribune, October 25th. Why exactly is the U.S. in Niger? And again, you know, if you watch the Democracy Now! Show, they're going to pronounce it Niger. Okay. Now, I told you about that, Maisha Johnson has a lot of questions, really good questions, actually, about why her husband, U.S. Army Sergeant, but David Johnson, a member of an elite Special Forces. You hear what I told you earlier, right? They signed up for these secret operations and whatnot. And they promised all kind of, you know, high rank kind of rewards if they, you know, make it out alive. Well, they didn't make it out. Him and them three others didn't make it out. You follow me? And she wanted to know, what was he doing over there? So that's what this article is about. Huh? Said three of his American comrades were killed during a murky military mission in the Central African nation of Niger earlier this month. Okay, I don't know how he got killed, where he got killed, or anything, Johnson, who is 6 months pregnant with her late husband's child, said in a recent interview with ABC News. I don't know that part. They never told me, and that's what I've been trying to find out since day one, since October 4th. What's appalling is that the powerful people who should be able to answer these simple questions seem to be completely clueless, and not just about what happened in the town of Togo Togo on the fateful day. Senator John McCain, chairman of the Senate Armed Forces Committee and the most influential member of Congress on defense issues, said the Trump administration has given him few details about what happened in Niger, while other key senators, including Democrats Chuck Schumer, Minority Leader Bob Casey of Pennsylvania and Republican Lindsey Graham, made the more shocking admission that, in Graham's words, they had no idea that there are more than 800 U.S. troops in Niger. Now, this Graham is a warmonger. You know what I'm saying? And McCain is too, as far as that go. And probably Schumer too. But I know this Graham and McCain, you understand, war hawks. But they claimed they didn't know what was going on. Like I said, any of you out there seen Clear and Present Danger with Harrison Ford and Willem Dafoe and James L. Jones? You understand? Not James L. Jones, what am I saying? What's his name? Voices in Darth Vader. What's his name? James L. Jones. I can't think of his name now, but y'all know what I'm talking about, right? His voice was Darth Vader, but he was in Clear Present Danger. He also played in Great White Hope. You understand what I'm saying? Something tell me I ain't saying his name right. Right? But nevertheless, if you ever saw Clear and Present Danger, that was the scenario in that they were sending this secret little army over into the jungles. You follow me, of South America to start blowing up these cocaine operations. You understand? And without the Congress up on Capitol Hill, without their knowledge. And that's what this sounds exactly like. Okay? That's why they all claim, yes, they're ignorant. I don't know what's going on, right? Okay? Now check this out. There's one question that no one has adequately answered, the most important one of all. Why are we in Niger, right? America. More broadly, what is the explanation and the broader strategy behind the ever-expanding U.S. military presence in Africa, where an umbrella of American troops now spreads from parts of Somalia, see that, Somalia, where they're getting all the blowing up, right? A largely lawless nation that has famously caused America heartbreak in the past, to Djibouti, where we have a large permanent base. You're going to hear about that if you watch that Democracy Now! Show, that I, one of them shows I'm telling you about that's dealing with Niger, okay? And they dealing with it extensively. You need to watch that, okay? Because they got the guy in there that was in Djibouti talking about it, okay? Say where we have a large permanent base, right? Cameroon and elsewhere with growing air force of unmanned drones that can spy on various African militias or villages or rain down weapons if need be. None of this debated by a largely in the dark American public, and none of this directly authorized by Congress, which is supposed to share in the power to wage war. Okay? See, that's a question. Says, let me read that again, because I want to get this where you can actually hear it the way it's presented. This is kind of long. It says, again, more broadly, what is the explanation and the broader strategy behind the ever-expanding U.S. military presence in Africa, where an umbrella of American troops now spreads from parts of Somalia, a largely lawless nation that has famously caused American heartbreak in the past, to Djibouti, where we have a large permanent base, Cameroon and elsewhere, with a growing air force of unmanned drones that can spy on various African militias or villages or rain down weapons if need be. None of this debated by a largely in the dark American public, and none of this directly authorized by Congress, which is supposed to share in the power to wage war. Is a serious life or death question that calls for thoughtful answers by serious people. That conversation should start with this. Under what authority are some 6,000 U.S. troops, a level of strength that America didn't hit in Vietnam until midway through the John F. Kennedy administration, and our fleet of flying death robots now serving in Africa? The pat answer that you get from the Pentagon and previously from the Obama administration, which carried out a good bit of our military expansion in Africa with little or no fanfare, and now the Trump administration would be the near unanimous 2001 congressional authorization for use of military force, which launched what used to be called the War on Terror and is now increasingly called Forever Wars. See, now that's one of the things that they brought into play with 9/11. When they perpetrated 9/11 back there in 2001, you know, Bush signed a lot of documents, you understand, new laws. You follow me, brought into law. They fighting terror now. You understand? That's the kind of stuff they come up with when they perpetrate these things like 9/11 and like the Oklahoma bombing and like the, you know, the first Trade Center bombing back there in 1993. You follow what I'm saying? And more than likely the Boston bombing. You follow me? They behind all of that kind of stuff. This thing just happened in New York yesterday. They probably behind that. Like I say, Manchurian Candidate. You dig? And then when they do these things, they bring on different laws that allow them to do things they wouldn't be able, according to the Constitution, which is null and void now, right? You understand? That they wouldn't be able to do anyway, that they don't have to go through Congress and get approval for. See what I'm saying? Okay. Says, said that resolution, of course, only really addressed the original Al-Qaeda group that was led by the Osama bin Laden. Here it is right here. That's who I was trying to think of earlier, right? You understand? And they claim that Osama bin Laden was killed back there when Obama was president, you know, in the last few years. Osama bin Laden had been killed years earlier. That Benazir Bhutto, she let that cat out the bag. I talked about that in the past. And when she let that out, about 2 months later, they assassinated her. You understand? Because she was revealing this stuff. They didn't want people, this revealed. See? So again, huh? Led by the wealthy Saudi Osama bin Laden, which was well-organized and well-funded and showed not only on 9/11, but in lesser operations like the 2000 attack on the USS Cole, that it was a threat to Americans at home and abroad. See, this is some more propaganda. They blame it on Osama bin Laden. See what I'm saying? He the fall guy, right? For these CIA operations. You follow what I'm saying? That was 16 years ago this autumn. Now bin Laden is dead, with his original group barely existing, and it's been replaced by various coalitions of bad actors and wannabe warlords who seem a lot less capable of striking U.S. citizens until we send our troops into their remote villages on military missions. Obama did publicly announce in 2013 that he was sending 100 U.S. troops to Niger in failure to address a militaristic U.S. policy that seems every problem around the world as a nail to be pounded by an $800 Pentagon hammer. You know, you understand what I'm saying? Overpriced stuff, right? This money they claim they're spending, you don't know where it's going. Obama passed the torch to the reckless President Donald Trump, who has given the generals carte blanche to expand the front line and the deadliness of our tactics. The number of innocent civilians killed by the American military has skyrocketed since January, and an expanded role for the Pentagon. You follow me? From sending more troops into the sinkhole that is Afghanistan to putting America's nuclear bombers on 24-hour alert for the first time since the end of the Cold War has become a dominant theme for Trump's America. Okay? Now check this out. I'm just cut to the chase. This is the end. Then, says, wait a minute. Said, if and when the despicable widow bashing ever stops, because they started bashing, you know, Johnson, because she wanted to know these things, and she was talking about how Trump responded to her, right? So they saying, if and when the despicable widow bashing ever stops, and after the Pentagon gets its story straight about what happened in Tongo, Trump or maybe Defense Secretary James Mattis, who comes off as a lot more trustworthy and honest, should go on national TV with a sweeping address that, while not compromising military tactics, should answer these three seemingly simple questions. Why are we in Niger? Why are we in Africa? In what nation is the U.S. military, more than 16 years after 9/11 attacks, still waging war against terrorism? And what is the strategy and perceived end dates of these conflicts? See, so now, when you see that, you got people asking that, and more than likely, that's why they push that boy's button yesterday in New York. You follow me? This is why we got to still be in these countries. We got terrorists here in America. You understand what I'm saying? See? You understand? That's why they did the Boston thing. More likely than not, set them boys up as patsies, right? Then that strategy needs to be written down in a new AUMF bill that needs to be sent to Congress and properly debated, not for a few hours, but for several weeks, with committee hearings and expert testimony, and then voted up or down, or better yet, amended to an anti-terrorism policy that actually makes sense. That's the way the founding fathers envisioned it going down when it came to the United States fighting war. Yeah, well, you understand, Esau got control of this bad boy. He runs this, and been running it now for, what, 100 years? You understand what I'm saying? Solid 100 years, right? Been influencing it way back past the Civil War, because I got something else in here about that, and I'm going to touch on it in a little bit, okay? So while I've tried to ignore most of the back and forth, I was struck by Trump's apparent comment in his now infamous phone call with Maisha Johnson, in which he apparently said that her late husband knew what he signed up for. See what I'm talking about? This person see it too. You follow me? And again, he signed up for something And you understand? And Trump let the cat out the bag by saying that. He knew what he signed up for. In other words, he was signed up for some clandestine operation and ended up getting killed with them other three. You follow me? And he was promised all kind of little perks if he carried it out and got back alive. Well, they did. You follow me? That's why they can't reveal what they was doing over there. Vinny said that that was insensitive, but we're missing the broader point. Right. But David Johnson didn't know what he signed up for in Niger. None of us does. That needs to change right away. Now, I disagree with this, the writer of this assessment. His name is Will Bunch. Okay? I think he did know, per se, what he was signing up for. He went for it. You follow what I'm saying? But got killed. Okay? You understand? It's just that the public doesn't know. Chicago Sun-Times. October 26th, Trump didn't authorize Niger mission that killed four soldiers, okay? He disavowed all night. He like Mission Impossible, right? Jim Phelps, if you get caught, disavow all knowledge and burn this tape up at the Mission Impossible, for those of you who know what I'm talking about, right? Trump disavowed all knowledge. I didn't have anything to do with that, you know, because he don't want to align himself with any failure. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. Said, very few follow Flake's Trump rebuke. GOP senators seem unwilling to advance colleagues' critique. See, a lot of them senators, they're not going in with Corker and Flake in knocking Trump because they understand who's behind Trump, who put Trump there. You understand? The House of Rothschild. So they scared of Rogers, so they ain't going up against Trump. You understand what I mean? So they not signed up with Flake. But check this out. Flake is the only one that sent the flyer back. He didn't even open it because he didn't want like he didn't have to open it because he knew what was in there. He didn't send it back. You follow what I'm saying? Now, okay? Because Flake more than likely is an Edomite. He knew what time it was. Probably shook him up. You understand? Without a doubt. Chicago Sun-Times, October 26th. NAACP warning could hinder airline industry. A recent advisory in Missouri hurt hotels there. Okay? Said the NAACP has issued a travel warning Tuesday for African-American travelers to exercise caution when flying American Airlines. Because, you know, there's been some bad stuff happening with people of color, Israelites, so-called African-Americans flying on American Airlines. I know many of you heard about it, okay? You know, they put a sister off. She didn't do anything for them, but she questioned why she was getting told that she had to get up off the plane to get somebody else up seat. She wasn't going to do it, so they put her off. And put who was riding with her, a Caucasian, right? You understand, the European was riding with her. They put him off with her, okay? And they've done some more stuff, too. So, you know, you got to watch that American Airlines. Because it was a judge here, one of us, right, here in Chicago. And she went to catch American Airlines. They told her she couldn't ride because she was on Homeland Security risk. And she's a judge. She was on the no-fly list and she didn't know it, okay? Okay, she about 50-something years old, and she said she went there, and they told her, no, you can't ride, you're on the Homeland Security watch list, you can't ride. She's like, what? And she's a judge here in Chicago, Illinois, a judge, a sitting judge, okay? They told her, you on the watch, and they had it on the TV the other week, man, just to see her not talking about it is funny, okay? You like, what? You understand? She a sitting judge. They told her she was on the watch list, couldn't fly. Okay, Chicago Tribune, October 26th, right? The Edomites on Wednesday, right? Israelis on Wednesday approved construction of nearly 200 new homes in the Jewish housing development of East Jerusalem, pushing ahead with a recent spike of settlement construction. The decision by Jerusalem officials came after last week's approval to move forward with roughly 3,000 new homes in the West Bank. See? Now, Esau forging ahead with his plan, right? You know, he confronting Yah, you know, like, Yah can't do nothing to me, I'm tough, right? Okay. Chicago Sun-Times, October 27th. European Central Bank to dial back stimulus. The European Central Bank will ease the pace of its bond-buying stimulus program. See, because that's how they've been staying off this collapse, buying the bonds themselves. So they say, we got to ease off. See, because there's only so much they can keep, you know, playing this out. If you look at that interview with Chris Whelan on Kaiser yesterday, October 31st, he tell you, he said, you know, there's nothing more they can do. He said, the pot is just going to boil over. You understand what I'm saying? Okay. It says, dialing back a measure that has supported the Eurozone economy's recovery from a debt crisis that threatened to break up the currency union. The ECB, you know, European Central Bank, said Thursday it would reduce its bond purchase to 30 billion euro or $35 billion, right, per month starting in January from 60 billion euro. So they're going to cut it in half, right, because they just printing paper. Okay, also, a lot more people have been brought out about this, you understand, molesting women and even boys, you know what I mean? Kevin Spacey, the actor, his show getting ready to be canceled, huh? Because this guy, young boy, who, when he was 14, Spacey made a move on him at a party. And the young boy now, he's of an age now, he just, you know, he brought this out. He's still in the movie game, this boy. His last name is Rapp, okay, R-A-P-P. You understand, Caucasian? I think he's about, he's in his 40s now. He brought this out about Spacey. He said Spacey threw him on the bed, Kevin Spacey threw him on the bed when he was 14. This is back like in 86. And Spacey acknowledged it, you know, so now they canceling his show. This is the last season for his show. You follow what I'm saying? Because and Spacey also came out and said he's homosexual, right? But this is the Weinstein effect. This is what they call it. Men are getting out and fired and it's spread. They got Weinstein at the top of the list, right? Roy Price, you probably heard about him, of Amazon Studios, literary editor Leon Weisletier, okay? Director James Toback, they say he done molested over 200-300 women, is Toback. Okay, celebrity chef John Best, journalist Mark Halpern. Okay, I think Halpern just got fired here the other day. They call it the Weinstein effect. Okay? Now, this is Esau and everybody like Esau. Everybody doing this nasty stuff. Whatever you, whoever you are, you're going to get revealed. It's getting brought out. So Chicago Sun-Times, October 27th. Kelly tells falsehood and likes. And like his boss, won't apologize. That's yes, there. This John Kelly, huh? You follow what I'm saying? White House chief of staff, he came out and backed up Trump and lied on the floor. The U.S. Representative Frederica Wilson, who was in the car with Maisha Johnson, the David Johnson's wife, when Trump came across the speakerphone, huh? And said what he said to Maisha Johnson. He knew what he was signing up for. You know, no real condolences, no real, you know, compassion, you understand what I'm saying? Just like Trump, right? Then he came back and denied it. Kelly came back and said Trump did say it, it just didn't come out right. Then he attacked Frederica Wilson, the U.S. Florida representative, lied on her, attacked her. You follow what I'm saying? It says Sergeant LaDavid Johnson's widow, Maisha, recalled the president saying that her husband knew what he signed up for, but it hurts anyway. And it made me cry. I was very angry at the tone of his voice and how he said it. Okay? I got something else in here about this Kelly and Woodby. Okay? Chicago Sun-Times, October 27th. Banks win while 401k investors could lose under Trump. You hear that? We'll see. I'm going to read it again. Banks win while 401k investors could lose under Trump. Okay, so after tweeting earlier in the week that there would be no change to your 401k, Trump, ever the sellout, sounded Wednesday like he could come around to scaling back tax breaks for retirement accounts. Okay, under President Trump, ordinary Americans keep losing. Earlier this week, Senate Republicans voted to kill a rule that would allow Americans to sue banks through class action lawsuits. You hear that? Earlier this week, Senate Republicans voted to kill a rule that would allow Americans to sue banks through class action lawsuits. Vice President Mike Pence cast the deciding vote. The House voted in July to repeal the rule, so the bill now heads to the president's desk. He is expected to sign it, effectively delivering a huge win to Wall Street. Finally, the hits will keep coming for Americans living on Main Street. Okay, as the GOP moves to hand rich Americans an enormous tax cut, some influential Republican lawmakers want to greatly reduce a tax break for people who wisely save money in employer-sponsored 401k retirement plan. Trump said Monday on Twitter he doesn't want 401k tax breaks to be touched, but some lawmakers haven't given up. Republicans see a president with little understanding of policy who will do just about anything for a big legislative win. You understand what I'm saying? See? Now, you follow me? I tell you, you know, they're going to keep on hitting the poor. Okay? And so that 401k is going south. I told you, they setting it up for the kill together with these pensions. Setting them up for the kill. Some of them already been killed. These pensions. Okay? October 28th. Chicago Sun-Times, higher fuel prices could spur airline fare increases. Okay, because again, the dollar's going south, so this is inflation. Everything is going to go up, because you're going to need more paper to pay bills. Simple as that, because the dollar losing its buying power. It's going out. That's why now they want to try to move people into this electronic currency, so they can keep playing these games. You follow what I'm saying? Because just like the dollar is not backed by anything, these electronic currencies won't be backed by anything. Smoke and mirrors. See? Also, church leaders denounced White Lives Matter rallies. Okay? They got White Lives Matter rallies now. Okay? I'm telling you, boy. It's off the chain. Okay? Also here, Chicago Tribune, October 25th. Right? FBI in touch with Des Plaines cops over alleged lynching threat online to this Frederica Wilson. You know, the person here in Des Plaines, Illinois, that had threatened to lynch Frederica Wilson. So they said the FBI they tracked that person down, they got in touch with him, right? You understand? Put the police on. Okay? I tell you, boy, yeah. Kelly's disgraceful and frightening failure to apologize to Frederica Wilson, the U.S. representative from Florida, right? You understand? That, again, that's her with the cowboy. She always wears a cowboy hat. You understand? She's some kind of colorful cowboy hat. And they saying that, you know, Kelly lied on her, Trump lied on her. You understand what I'm saying? But they won't apologize. But she was in the car with Maisha Johnson when she heard Trump, and she said what he said. She confirmed what Maisha Johnson said. Huh? Okay. Now, Chicago Tribune, October 28th. Drug exec charged in opioid scandal. Okay? Now, this is Fed's alleged billionaire with Chicago ties led effort to bribe doctors to prescribe painkiller. And this guy is Incense Therapeutics founder John Kapoor, KAPOOR, also his longtime chairman of Lake Forest-based Acorn Pharmaceuticals. This is him here, John Kapoor. Okay, now you tell me, but if you can maybe figure out what he is, his nationality, right? Okay, kind of look like one of us, right? Now he might be Edomite. You understand what I'm saying? I don't know, but he's 74 years old, and they done charged him in opioid, you know, pushing these, you understand, doctors to prescribe the painkillers so he could make money. He a billionaire, okay? He's a billionaire. Wait a minute, I know it says it in here. You know what I mean? It says Kapoor is the longtime chairman of the board at Acorn, which is being acquired by German healthcare company Fresenius Kabi for $4.3 billion. Okay, now Kapoor, a Phoenix resident listed by Forbes, is having a net worth of $1.75 billion. He's been Acorn's chairman since 1990. And he's just a drug dealer. That's all he is. Okay?
Okay?
I'm telling you, boy. That's what I got another article I'm going to deal with because I haven't really had a chance to really read it like I want to yet. I deal with that in the Q&A. All right? About these opioids and the family that's, you understand, came up with Oxycontin, Oxycodone, or Codone, and Oxycodone. You understand? And they multi-billionaires. And their names is Sacklers. And they Edomite, the Edomite family out of Queens. You follow what I'm saying? Queens, New York. The Sacklers. Edomite family. They've been in this, you understand, pushing these painkillers, these opioid painkillers for years. And they was multi-millionaires coming up here to so many years back. And now when they started this new campaign for this oxycodone and oxycontin, Percocet, and oxycodone, now they become multi-billionaires over the last so many years. Big article about it, okay? And that's one of the shows on Democracy Now. Amy Goodman had this guy, Glazik, on there, young journalist, Caucasian. He running it all down. And his article is in the Esquire. Okay, and we got the Esquire here the other week. I ain't had a chance to really read it yet, but it's a nice big article about these Sacklers. He was running it down on the Democracy Now show. Like I said, you look at those shows, he's on one of them. Most of the show is him. And he's running this stuff down, okay? And this is, again, I bring these things out. This is prophecy, right? How I die, hidden things, secret things, sought up and searched out, old Esau. Okay? But I deal with that article, like I said, on the Q&A. Chicago Sun-Times, October 29th, white nationalists rally in two Tennessee cities. So they got these Caucasians rallying now. White Lives Matter, right? Okay? In two Tennessee cities. You follow me? And more likely, just like Esau is behind the Black Lives Matter, he's behind his White Lives Matter, too. He's the one funding it. Again, diversify. You follow what I'm saying? Divide and conquer. Keep mess going. By any means necessary. Okay? Chicago Tribune, October 29th. Same late, unequal rates. Why water bills are surging and why black and poor suburbs pay more. That's here in Chicago and Illinois. You understand? Basically, Chicago and the Chicago area provides the water, Chicago does, to these surrounding suburbs, way up north, over west, and south of Chicago. You follow what I'm saying? They supply the water for these suburbs. You understand? And they charge these suburbs. But this is an extensive investigative article by the Chicago Tribune. And they call it the water drain. And how, you understand, poor folks and you understand, people of color, Israelites, who poor communities, they paying a lot more than these rich Edomite and Caucasian communities, you understand, are paying for what? Okay? They got the breakdown over in here. You understand what I'm saying? Let me just read this to you. It's a big article. Real big. Okay? But check this out. Now, these are the municipalities, and then it's going to tell you the population and the median household income as of 2015, right? And then it's going to tell you the majority of the, you know, nationality of the people that's in this area. Now, this is Indian Head Park. 3,047 is the population. The median household income is $81,000, a little over, $81,013. The majority, they're white, Caucasian, right? European, if you will, right? Monthly water rates, 5,000 gallons a month. They pay at $87.50, okay, a month. Now, Ford Heights, that's us. You understand? They don't know just how many of us live in Ford Heights. Very poor African-American community, Israelite community. Medium household income, $21,050. That's the median, you know, household income. Okay? And the majority raised black, right? That's what they got here, right? Know what they pay a month for water? $85 a month. Now, you see that? You understand? $85 a month they pay. But the average one ain't making but $21,000 a month, I mean a year. The average household out there in Midian, you know, Indian Head Park, where it's mostly Caucasians, right? The average monthly income, a yearly income is $81,000. You understand what I'm saying? Four times what it is in Ford Heights, but they only pay $2.50 more than what Ford Heights resident pay. Okay? Now check this out. Bannockburn, 1583 is the population. The average median income a year, $103,611, right? $103,611. People who live there, white, Caucasian, European, right? They pay $84.90 a month. Okay, Clarendon Hills, about 8,500 is the population, right? The median yearly income, $105,720. White, European is who live there, right? Basically, right? You know how much they pay? $79.85 a month, right? For water. Prospect Heights, $2,275 is the, you know, population. Median household income, $61,442. White, European, right? They pay $76.63 a month. For what? Maywood, $24,000, right? Median house yearly income, $42,298. That's us, black, right? Israelites, right? They pay $72.61 a month for what? Okay? Franklin Park, $18,333 is the population. $55,926 is the average median income. Population white, right? They pay $69.52 a month for water. Glenwood, $8,956 is the population. $54,544 is the median, you know, yearly income. Black, you know, Israelite, basically, right? They pay $67.60 a month. Okay? Phoenix, okay? $1,964 is the, you know, population. They make about $31,000 a year. That's us too, black, right? $67.36 a month for water bill. Okay, Dixmoor, population unavailable. Median income, $38,061. That's us too, right? Israelite, black, right? They pay $67.24 a month for water. Now check this. Bottom five water rates. Chicago, 5,365,598 is the population. The average median income, $48,522. Okay, no majority, it's mixed, right? You understand? Latinos, Hispanics, Israelites, Caucasians, so on and so forth, right? Average monthly water bill, $19.40. Okay, Wilmette, 95,000 is the population. The average yearly income, $132,110. Caucasian, white, right? You know what they pay a month? $17.67 a month for water. And they making over $100,000, over $130,000 a year. All right. Waukegan, $90,622. Average income, the average of income a year, $45,845. Hispanic, okay, they pay $15.55 a month, right, for water. Highland Park, $29,768. Average yearly income, $122,829. White, right? A lot of Edomites live up there too. And in some of these other places, but nevertheless, white, right? Average monthly payment for water, $14.43 a month. Evanston, you know, basically Edomites, right? They don't say white, but it's basically Edomites. It's pretty Caucasians live up there too. Population a little over 74,000, right? The average yearly income, $70,041. They pay $13.71 a month. See what I'm saying? You see all this inequity, buying a low stature, huh? Inequity. 59th chapter of Yeshaya, under the curse. And that's the reality of it. We pay more, get less. Huh? We pay more, get less. Okay? Chicago Tribune, October 29th. Trump's weak response to the opioid overdose epidemic. See? And see, again, when they say epidemic, you know it's plenty Caucasians and Edomites that's caught up in this, you understand, using these opioids. Because, you understand, if it was just us, people of color and Hispanics, no problem. They're not going to have all this uproar about it. And we've been ensconced into this for years. No uproar. But now, this thing is, man, it's hitting these Caucasian and these Edomite communities hard. And so now, you know, it's like, you understand, for all of you saw the first Godfather movie, right? And so after World War II, you understand, Esau started bringing the heroin in, and he wanted basically to concentrate on our community, Israelite community. And so you saw the first Godfather, you know, when they had the big council and about this drug, what was going to go down about this drug, right? You understand what I mean? And the one from Cleveland said, in my city, we keep it in the dark, the colors. You understand? They are animals anyway, so let them lose their soul. And that's the reality of it. That's what Francis Ford Coppola is showing. That's who the drug, the heroin, was really supposed to hit. You understand? The Israelite communities. And again, like I said before, they saw us waking up more and more and more from 1896. Remember what Lord Bertrand Russell said in 1900, Illuminati guy, 28 years old at the time. We got to get ready to get rid of these useless evils. And as you come up, you know, from 1897, when the House of Rothschild took the Theodore Herzl movement, the Zionist movement, you understand, to the land, that was an attack on Israel. That was an attack on Yah and Yah's way. You understand, Esau going to put the Edomites there, which was prophesied in Obadiah, right? You understand, those who eat of thy bread, those who took you to the borders, prophesied in Malachi chapter 1. Esau said when the Romans kicked them out, when they kept rebelling against Roman rule, and they got kicked out in 135 CEAD, then, you understand, Esau said, huh, we shall return one day and build the desolate ways. And what did Yah say? Yeah, you shall return and you shall build. Isn't that what I've been reading this session and read in sessions prior? Huh, all this building, they still doing huge building now, right? It's hastening, getting more so, right? On the West Bank, right? In Jerusalem, right? On occupied territory, right? You understand? And Yah said, well, yeah, you should return and you should build, but I will throw down and you're going to be called the borders of wickedness. And we were going to see, and we were saying in our heart, Yah going to be magnified from the border of Israel. Prophecy being fulfilled right before our eyes. You follow me? Now, again, you follow what I'm saying? They started hitting us with these drugs because this is an attack. But now, like Marlon Brando said when he talked about it, when he was sitting in the council, what did he say? He said, you understand, we got gambling, huh? We got loan sharking. That's all right. He didn't mention the whore. They had that too, you know, prostitution. That's all right. He said, you know, the pastor Savanti of the church allowed that. You understand what I mean? He allowed a whoredom, the prostitution and the gambling, huh? And the extortion, the loan, the Jews loan. They allow that. He said, but this drugs, he said, this is gonna destroy us in years to come. And this is what you understand is being put forth here. You follow me? This is what we see is materialized now. You follow me? Because Brando is saying in the first Godfather, huh? Francis Ford Coppola, Mario Puzo, I never read the book. You understand what I mean? But I don't know if Mario Puzo, I know he's the one who wrote the book, The Godfather. He was like, you understand, an advisor. So I don't know if this was his man or this is Francis Ford Coppola's man when they put this forward in the movie. But they were saying, huh, you understand, this drugs is going to destroy us in years to come. Yeah, it produced a lot of money. But eventually you're going to look up. He said, these same politicians who's, you understand, who's friendly with us now, these same police officials who's friendly with us now, who we can bribe and let us run the prostitution, let us run the juice loan and extortion, let us run, You understand? The gambling. You understand? They're going to turn against us. Why? Because they sons and daughters, they grandsons and granddaughters going to eventually be hit by this opioid, this heroin. You understand? You understand what I'm saying? They're going to be hit by this, and they're going to become addicts, and then they're going to turn against us. See, but this is from the Illuminati Edomite up top. See, he recessed all the way back in the dark. And when he sent this down, you understand, through his tentacles, huh? His minions who want to be rich, who want, you understand, economic gain, you understand, they don't care nothing about it. They greedy. But some of them did. Some of them want to participate in this. You know, all money, not good money. See, and that's what Brando putting forth in that first Godfather. Now we seeing, huh, the fruition of this. We seeing the maturation of this. We seeing the fulfillment of what he was saying. What that line in that Godfather, this is going to destroy us in time to come. And now, you see what I say? Trump's weak response to opioid overdose epidemic. See, because this is from the Illuminati Edomite. You understand? And these Edomite families who've been producing these opioids. See, because look, when you say opium, you understand, the average person, they think about what? They think about the heroin, the powder that's being sold out here on the street corners. You understand? In these in our communities, right? And in Caucasian communities to whatever degree, right? Without a doubt, right? Okay, but definitely in our community. You understand? That's what they think about. See? They think about, you know, chasing the dragon. You understand what I'm saying? Like you heard on the song, you know, I can't think of the name. I got it on the cut. You understand? The group that's singing, you know, it's a Caucasian group, you know, chasing the dragon. You know what I mean? Some of you might have heard it, right? They think about that. But they didn't think about these opioid, this opium, this morphine that's in these pills. See? The oxycodone, it's a time-release pill. You understand that they feed into a lot of these cancer patients. But you get these other people who drop it too. It's time release into the system. See, that's what these Sacklers came up with. Like I said, I'm going to have that on the Q&A. See, because I got to read this article. I got to, you know, brush up on it more. You understand? But this family of Edomites out of Queens, New York, they the ones that came up. They've been in this opioid for years. Okay, years. You follow me? They've been pushing this stuff, and then they've been marketing it a certain way. And when they started, like I say, when they developed this time-release opium pill, opioid pill, this oxycodone, okay, or oxycontin, right? And then they had the oxycodone. You follow me? And then they had the oxycodone. You dig? Oxycodone. You understand? I think it's D-O-N-E, but I was having a conversation here few days ago, and they said it's oxycodone, like D-O-M-E, but like I said, I don't know when I read this article and have it for you on the Q&A. You follow me, that'd be, you know, on the Sabbath. But the deal is, Yah's bringing all this out. Can't hide anymore. The bed, Yeshua chapter 20, bed shorter than you can stretch out on, the covering narrower than these Edomites can wrap themselves up in. You understand? Yah revealing, right? Again, Obadiah, right? How are thy hidden things, secret things, sought up and searched out, O Esau? You follow me? That's what's going on. See? And now, like I say, not only on them, but anybody, everybody. What you do, what you've done, you understand? Y'all bringing it out. See what I'm saying? Nobody can hide. This daughter of Babylon can't hide. That's why I just read the article. You understand? Touched on that article. What are we doing in Niger? That was a, you understand, an editorial opinion for the Chicago Tribune. What are we really doing in Niger? What are we really doing in Africa? What's all this secret stuff? Got drone operations, drone bases. Some shut down and can be opened up. You're going to hear that when you watch that Democracy Now! Show. It's one of them shows I called out. When you watch it, they're going to be talking about this. They got drone bases set up. Some of them shut down right now. They were open. They shut them down. They can reopen them at the drop of a hat. You understand? And fly these drones in and drop these bombs on people. Some of them is up in operation. They got one huge one that is in Djibouti. That's what that brother going to be talking about on that Democracy Now! Show. You understand? One of them brothers. Okay, that was over there in. I think he's in Djibouti. You follow me? Like I said, all this coming out, see? And again, you put it with that Pompeo, what he say? The president is giving us license, the CIA, we gonna get real vicious. He said that, we gonna get real vicious now. See, and what would make them get vicious like this? This is coming from the Illuminati Edomite at the top, the House of Rothschild. What would make them get vicious like this now? Because this thing is sinking, it's crumbling, it's breaking up right before their eyes. And they can see it, and they're trying to hold on. Just like all your dictators, right? When the people start getting hip to the dictator, huh? And they started building these revolutions, start building the dictator thing, all he has to do is get more vicious and put it down. But it never works. Because when the people really get hip to the dictator, they say, hey, it's over with, partner. You got to go. You understand? You got to go. Because we're going to remove you one way or another. You either going to kill us all off, or you're going to have to go. Simple as that. I didn't talk about this in the past. You understand? The dictator always trying to hold on to power. He gets more and more vicious. And the people get more and more resistant. Because why? He's naked. The dictator's naked. They see it now. They see it. They see him totally naked. Without any clothes on. And they say, yeah, we them, you understand? Like I said, you can fool some of the people some of the time. You can fool some of the people all the time, but you can't fool all the people all the time. And now it's that time. Because Yah is what? Bringing the light on everything, exposing everything and everybody. Nobody can hide. Nothing can be hid. Okay? See? So that's why, you understand, Trump's weak response to the opioid epidemic. You understand? That's why. Because he working for the Illuminated Edomites, sitting in over there in England or Germany, wherever the house of, you know, Jacob the Rothschild is sitting, he taking orders. See? You follow me? Like I said, the queen, she gets her cut, Elizabeth, you know, $500 million a year. I read in one of these books we got here. You understand? The Politics of Heroin, Alfred McCoy. You follow what I'm saying? We got some book, cover books here. Like I said, this stuff been coming out. You follow what I'm saying? Just like I said earlier in this session again, you know, I don't know Alfred McCoy. I don't even know if he's still alive. But I got his book in there. Follow what I'm saying? This guy right here. You understand? Or should I say, better yet, this boy Glassy. That you'll see on the Democracy Now! Show that I got the article in the Esquire that I got to read that I'm going to talk about on the Q&A. I don't know him, but he's bringing out. Yah's working through him bringing out this truth about these Sacklers. These Edomite family out of Queens, New York, been pushing these opioids for years. Okay? Through all kind of advertisement campaigns. You understand? Putting it on the people to take this, take that. This will be good for this. And they making money. Ain't nothing but drug dealers. You hear that boy Glassick say, these pain clinics has popped up like drug dealers on the corner all across America, pushing these opioids. You follow me? He talks about how, you understand, these pain clinics jump up, and these doctors in there, where they was maybe ordering, when the Sacklers, before they started this advertisement campaign here some years back, about these Oxycontin and whatnot, he said, you know, they might have been only having 700, you understand, oxycodone, selling only 700, maybe every 2-3 months or something like that. You understand? He said, because a lot of people, when they saw that term oxycodone, he said, they know codeine is like addictive. So people, you know, shy away. But when they changed it to oxycodone, you understand, and Oxycontin, well, they ain't seeing that codeine, so it don't register. And then they started up a new advertisement campaign attacking the people's minds. See? And the people blind, don't have any understanding. Plus, people be, you know, they eating all this garbage, eating unclean stuff they shouldn't be eating, eating all this other GMO crap. You understand what I mean? And drinking all this crap that Esau got out here for them, so they get cancer, get the parasites in them, huh? Get the disease, then they get pain, then they go to the doctor, and then, you understand, the Sacklers got the doctors hooked up, pushed my product, and you get your cut. Drug dealers, you push my product, you get your cut. See? And this will ease pain, and it's just like morphine, right? You understand? Morphine, you watch the thing on the Civil War, morphine, when they discovered that, that was a huge discovery. Because then, you understand, I done talked about it a few years back, right? You understand? They out there fighting in the Civil War that Esau started. And I'm going to that in a minute. You understand what I mean? And you understand? And get an arm blown off, and then they give him that morphine, and the soldier could be sitting there with his arm blown off, and he all right, he ain't hollering in pain because he can't feel anything. Get his leg blown off. He ain't feeling anything. He ain't feeling no pain. You follow me? Look at some of them movies way back there, like Gone with the Wind. And look at that scene in Atlanta. You understand? When Sherman was coming and all them wounded soldiers of the Confederacy was up in this huge church. And they was laying up in there with limbs blown off, eyes blown out. And you don't hear nothing but moaning and ailing and whatnot. And Scarlett O'Hara, Vivian Leigh, she go up in there and she won't leave. And the doctor, the old doctor told her, say, you can't go, you got to stay. And she said, I'm tired of all this death and blood. And he said, listen, you got to stay here and help out. He said, look, you think I'm not tired? He said, look at all these boys with limbs blown off. He said, in agony, and I can't do nothing for them. He said, I don't even have anything for their pain. I don't even have morphine for their pain. You follow me? Because when they give them that morphine, they can lay there, you know, blood might be oozing out. They don't feel anything. So that's what that morphine does, but it's not curing the problem. See? People get that cancer, them worms eating on them. They give them that time-release Oxycontin pill. They can drop that. They don't feel anything. But the worms still eating on them. You follow me? See, that's what these Edomites, I'm telling you, they cause all this death and destruction, all this darkness. You follow me? And they're getting rich at the same time. And attacking the host like the parasites that they are. And that's why they was put out of them 110 countries. They started with the Romans in 135 CEAD. Went to Carthage. Man, I read this some of this the other week, right? Coming all the way up. That's why they said we need a place that we can operate from, where we out from up under these kings and queens. Isn't that how America was set up? To get away from the monarchies? Look at your history. See? That's again why when you look at the story of Dracula, you understand, he showed no reflection in the mirror. That was Abraham Stoker in his book, huh? Dracula, the Prince of Darkness. He's telling us, what is that symbolical of? Huh? Like I said, if you ever see that one with Frank Langella, he walk in the room and Laurence Olivier is standing there at the fireplace, big huge mirror over the fireplace. And it's that kind of dog in the room, and Laurence Olivier is standing there, and he didn't realize that Dracula is the one that's standing praying on the people. So Dracula come into the room, and he shuts the door, and Olivier looks around, and he says, Count Dracula, I didn't hear you come in. And Dracula said, I've been told I got a light footstep. And then Olivier, he's looking through this huge mirror, and he can see that part of the room, but you can't see Dracula. He shows no reflection in the mirror. And so Lawrence Olivier said, yeah, Count. He said, I'm looking at the room through this mirror here, and it's showing the room, but I can't see you. And Dracula goes and picks up a vase and throws it and breaks the mirror all up, right? Now, what is that symbolical of? Huh? Esau has tried to hide himself historically, where you can't go back and see his reflection in history. When you go into these, you understand, Bible dictionaries, you look up Esau, you get to read about him like the Unger's Bible Dictionary. What is it going to tell you at the end? The Edomites became extinct. They don't exist anymore. See? Because Esau did what? He started calling himself Israel. You follow me? He started saying he was us. He shows no reflection. Per se. But as I said in the past, you got to be able to track Esau. If you can't track Esau, then you're going to be confused. You're going to not understand. Like many of my people, the majority of the Israelites I've seen that have awakened to the fact of Israel. I'm not talking about the ones of us who haven't. I'm only talking about the ones who have, right? They basically, all the ones I've seen, they all think that was us back there in the first century BCE. The latter part of the second century BCE. They all think that was Israel in the first and second century CE AD. That wasn't. That was Esau. You got to be able to track him. But see, he don't want to show any reflection historically. See? Tries to wipe out his tracks. You get it? Chicago Tribune, October 29th. Flake's exit opens door to other GOP hopefuls. Yeah, right? See, Flake gone. Flake say, I'm out of here. Okay. Okay. Also, 5 years after Sandy, recovery rocky in places. You hear that? 5 years after Sandy, recovery is rocky in places. Okay? I said it back then, didn't I say it? Those of you who heard me when I talked about Sandy. What did I say? They got all this chutzpah now. Huh? They got all this hubrisness. We gonna build back. You can't keep us down, just like you heard Trump say about Texas, Houston, right? And when he said it, y'all had taken, what was it, Harvey? He had taken it back away from Houston. And when Trump said that, huh? Y'all brought it back. Okay? Since they so tough. And since you so prideful and arrogant. Right? See? And I said then, yes, Dad, these people, some of these people ain't gonna never recover from Sandy. And many of them people never gonna recover from Harvey and Irma and what was it, Jose, and I can't even think of all the hurricanes that came. Yes, Dad, they hit all the marriages. You follow what I'm saying? They're not gonna recover ever. Not here, not doing what they're doing, right? You follow what I'm saying? Also, 23 dead, over 30 injured in an attack on Mogadishu Hotel. Mogadishu. Okay? Again, Somali, right? Somalia. Esau got stuff going on down there, keeping crap going. You follow what I'm saying? Now, this is real stuff. This is historical stuff here. You know, you can't get away from the truth. All right? Chicago Sun-Times, October 31st. Potent weather bomb leaves 1 million powerless in Northeast. Okay? You see that? Tree down, man, across the road. Car got to turn around and go back the other way. Now, that's just a storm that they had. This is in Freeport, Maine. This happened Sunday night. So there were plenty reports, many reports of impassable roads across New England. Okay. Chicago Sun-Times, October 31st. Congress plots to rob Americans three ways. Now, this is from this Robert Rice. He used to be in the Clinton administration. See? But he's talking about, he said, you know the plot. The bank robbers set off a bomb down the street from the bank. And while everyone's distracted, they get away with the loot. In the reality TV show, we're now suffering through. Donald Trump is the bomb. The robbers are the American oligarchs who bankroll the Republican Party and who are plotting the biggest heist in American history. A massive tax cut estimated to be up to $5.8 trillion. Around 80% of it will benefit the richest 1%. Okay? Trump is busily distracting America with his explosive tweets and incendiary tantrums blasting Republican Senators Jeff Flake and Bob Corker, NFL players who take the knee, dreamers, refugees, immigrants, transgender people, the media, Rocket Man, Hillary Clinton, Obama, NAFTA, Muslims. See, that's the distraction. See, you follow me? Said the Trump bomb is usually damaging, unleashing hate, threatening democratic institutions, isolating America and the world. But none of this seems to bother Republicans in Congress, except for a handful of senators who won't be running again. That's because congressional Republicans are concentrating their efforts on pulling off the giant heist for their rich patrons. Okay? But the fall of the dollar, they see it. They're trying to enrich themselves to move money into something else, more likely silver, gold, some kind of, you understand, commodity that's not going to, deflate as the dollar drops. Okay, so they scrambling, right? Says they want to move quickly so no one notices, passing the tax cut before Xmas, Christmas, right? With no hearings and minimal debate. If the plot succeeds, most Americans will be robbed in three ways. First, they'll lose tax deductions they rely on, such as the deduction on earnings they put into tax deferred savings and 401k plans. Some 55 million Americans now rely on 401k plans to save for retirement. They'll also lose the deduction for what they pay in state and local taxes. More than half of this deduction now goes to taxpayers with incomes of less than $200,000. Republicans say the middle class will come out just fine because they'll get a larger standard deduction. Not true. The average American's tax bill will rise because the deductions they'll lose will total more than the higher standard deduction Republicans have proposed. Second, most Americans will lose government services that will have to be eliminated in order to pay for the giant tax cut, including very likely some Medicare and Medicaid. About $1.5 billion in Medicare and Medicaid cuts were quietly included in the budget resolution Republicans just passed in order to get their tax bill through the Senate with just 51 votes. No one paid attention because Trump was attacking grieving combat widows. Yeah, that's the distractions, right? He attacking Maisha Johnson. Third, most Americans will have to pay higher interest on their car and mortgage loans and other money they borrow because the huge tax cut will explode the national debt. That debt is now around $20 trillion. It's really around $260 trillion. Okay? Or 70% of the total economy. If it goes much higher, it will crowd out borrowing and force interest rates upward. Putting all this together, the theft would be the largest redistribution from the bottom 90% to the richest 1% in history. Republicans' biggest fear is that word of the heist will leak out to the public and their tax bill will be defeated by a handful of Senate Republican holdouts who feel the public pressure. That's exactly what happened with their plan to repeal the Affordable Care Act. The GOP's big money patrons pushed for the repeal not because they had any principled objection to the act, but because they didn't want to fork over $144 billion in taxes on incomes over $1 million to pay for the act over the next decade. In the end, Republicans couldn't get away with it because Americans learned that more than 23 million people would lose their health coverage and Medicaid would also be on the chopping block. Trump was willing to distract the public's attention to give congressional Republicans a shot at repeal. But the moment the public started catching on, he blew their cover. After the Congressional Budget Office announced the consequences of the Republican health bill, Trump called it mean. He could do the same with the tax bill. He almost has. When word leaked out last week that Republicans were planning to limit 401k deductions, Trump tweeted that it wouldn't happen and then backtracked on his tweet. Said the money interests who run the GOP depend on Trump bomb to divert attention from their huge heist. Okay? Their challenge is to make sure the bomb doesn't go off in the wrong direction. You follow me? Smoke and mirrors, distractions, why they pulling all this nonsense on the public. And the public is unaware really what's going on in most instances. But again, y'all bring the light out. He's bringing all this out. Right? Chicago Sun-Times, November the 1st. New Jersey sues Oxycontin maker. That's these Sacklers, right? New Jersey filed a lawsuit Tuesday against the company that manufactures Oxycontin, claiming a direct link between the state's opioid crisis and the firm's deceptive marketing practices. Okay? Okay? Purdue Pharma. You understand? Say they gonna, you understand? They vigorously deny that they've been doing these, you know, with these allegations, and they are deeply troubled by the opioid crisis. Yeah, right. They multi-billionaires because of it. You understand? That's just some damage control. And it's not going to do any good because they've been revealed. Okay? November the 1st, Chicago Sun-Times. 15 hospitals flunk safety ratings. Infections and medical errors among causes. Okay? You understand? These hospitals are not, you know, many of these hospitals are not doing what they're supposed to do. You know, we have talked about that in the past. Huh? The service, the morale is shot. And that's why all these infections and stuff happening in the hospitals. 15 hospitals flunk safety ratings. Okay? Chicago Sun-Times, November the 1st. At least 8 die, 11 hurt in New York terror attack. Okay? Truck hits bike path near trade center. And like I said, was he a Manchurian candidate? Okay? That's some more distractions, right? And again, Chicago Sun-Times, November the 1st. This is an opinion from the editorial section of the Sun-Times. General Kelly's dangerous myth about the Civil War. Okay? Because Kelly said the Civil War was fought by the South to preserve the institution of slavery. Pure and simple. The Confederate states themselves left no doubt about this in their formal declarations of secession. See, but again, you understand this Kelly, like many people's minds, and he's trying to push the same agenda that the Civil War started because of slavery. It didn't start because of no slavery. It was started by the illuminated Edomite, as we said here, and that many books that we got here, some books without a doubt, and articles tell you. It was all started by the Illuminati. You understand? To get control of America. Divide and conquer. And that's what they did here. You follow what I'm saying? Now check this out. Quite naturally, the South wanted slaves, but they had slaves in the North. We still slaves to this day, aren't we? What is happening for us here? After the Civil War, we were supposed to be free. Well, you understand? What's changed? You understand what I'm saying? We still getting shot down. We getting in prison, right? The jails is full of us, which is fulfillment of chapter 42. We fill up the prison house. I just read that earlier in this session, and many of you done read it, if not all of you out there, right? Chapter 42, you shy. Huh? We fill up the prison houses. They started this basically when? In 1970. When? After, they saw the brothers go to Demona. You understand? When the last bunch went up in there. Billy me and them in March 1970. That's when they intensified up the tempo on the attack on us. See, but it was escalating even, you understand, when they saw them leave here in 1967. They started escalating the attack with the drugs and the guns. You follow me? See what I'm saying? And then in 70 on up, bro, taking us out of jobs, maybe bring with our straw, taking all the jobs up out of here, huh? And basically hitting us specifically. The males of us. And then we end up going to the jailhouse. Huh? You follow me? To the prison industrial complex, right? Michelle Alexander, the new Jim Crow, which they was employed in Reconstruction, 1865, when the Civil War ended. So you understand? The slavery is still in effect. We still being hit. It's just all in the mind. These Negroes think they not oppressed. They not enslaved. See, they've been dumbed down. They, as Yah says in chapter 66, Yeshaya, they've chosen their own ways. I'm going to choose their delusions. And these Israelites, as many Caucasians are deluded with America. See? That's why you got so many Caucasians going into the opioid, going into the drugs, using drugs, because they've been disillusioned, and now they're awaiting to the fact they don't have no future. In debt, no job, owe all this money for school. You understand what I'm saying? So they're like, let me get high and forget about all of this. Going into the land of Ubladi. Give me some more of that oxycodone. You understand? I want the time release where I don't never get sober. You understand what I mean? I'm telling you, that's what's going on. All right? Now check this out. This is this Mary Mitchell here, this Israelite that I didn't cite before that writes for the Chicago Sun-Times. Kelly's remarks insult African Americans. All right? And she said, Chief of Staff John Kelly fits right in with the weirdness going on in the White House. During an interview with the provocative Laura Ingraham Monday night, Kelly praised Robert E. Lee, the commander of the Confederate Army of Northern Virginia, as an honorable man. First of all, there was no honor in slavery. This is her, right? Period. Worse yet, Lee wasn't only a slaveholder, he was history's biggest defender of the institution. When Kelly was asked about a Virginia church's decision to remove plaques honoring Lee and George Washington, he could have punted. Instead, Kelly went whole hog. I think we make a mistake, though, as a society and certainly as individuals when we take what is accepted today as a right and wrong and go back to 100, 200, 300 years. It shows you a lack of appreciation for history and what history is, Kelly said. I can't imagine him saying that about the Holocaust or Adolf Hitler. You understand what I mean? That's what she said. But Kelly didn't see a problem heaping praise on Lee. He was a man that gave up his country to fight for his state, which 150 years ago was more important than country. It was always loyalty to state first back in those days. Now it's different today. But the lack of an ability to compromise led to the Civil War. And men and women of good faith on both sides made their stand where their conscience had them make their stand. I expect such absurd statements to come from tiki-toting and white nationalists who have come out of the shadows since Trump took over the White House. That's what her response is to what Kelly said, right? Now, here's another Kelly quote. White House Chief of Staff John Kelly needs a history lesson. The Civil War was not a disagreement between men and women of good faith on both sides. It was a struggle for the soul of this country. Thankfully, the right side won the war. This is her, Mary Mitchell, right? The right side won the war, and slavery is no longer the law of the land. Matter of fact, this is said the Congressional Black Caucus in a written statement. So this is from the Professional Black Caucus that said that, right? Okay, in 1850, Lee argued that slavery is a greater evil to the white man than to the black race. You hear this? I want you to beam in on this. This is what Robert E. Lee said in 1850. He argued that slavery is a greater evil to the white man than to the black race. This is what Lee said. Check it now. The blacks are immeasurably better off here than in Africa, morally, socially, and physically. The painful discipline they are undergoing is necessary for their instruction as a race, and I hope will prepare and lead them to better things. How long their subjugation may be necessary is known and ordered by a wise, merciful providence. He wrote in a letter dated December 27, 1856. Now, this is 5 years before the Civil War. Now, the first what he said was in 1850, 11 years before the Civil War. You understand? So did Lee know that we were Israelites? I'm going to read this part again. You see what he said? He said, the painful discipline they are undergoing is necessary for their instruction as a race, and I hope will prepare and lead them to better things. How long their subjugation may be necessary is known and ordered by a wise, merciful providence. Yah! Isn't that why Yah sent us into these nations? And the ones of us that stayed put us up under other people, the ones of us that stayed in the land, took all the understanding from us so that we could be whipped. Sound like Lee knew who we were, who we were and who we are. That's what it sounds like to me. Huh? A merciful providence. In other words, how long they gonna need to get their butts whipped before they get some sense and understand they got to serve the Creator. That's what it sounds like to me. But Mary Mitchell don't understand that. Like I said, we sent her 5 years ago. You understand? No response. Because she a Christian. So she don't understand who she is. So she can't understand this quote of Lee. These two quotes. 1850, 1856. She can't understand where Lee coming from. But Lee evidently understood we were Israel. So he knew we had to get our butts whipped by the Father. Huh? Again, what did Lee say? How long their subjugation may be necessary is known and ordered by a wise, merciful providence. Okay? See? Now, Mary Mitchell, she don't understand that. So she is Israelite and can't see. She got the idol set up in her heart. You follow me? See? She think that was immoral. That's her response. That's the last thing she said. You understand? It was an immoral argument then and an even more immoral one today. She don't understand why we in this position and been in this position for over 2,700 years. You understand? With the 10 tribes or part of the 10 tribes and the other 10 tribes, you know, still over 2,700 years because the bulk of them was taken out later and then the rest was put under subjection. And then, you understand, with Yehuda, Benjamin, and Lewis, right? You understand what I'm saying? 606. So over 2,600 years with Benjamin, Yehuda, and Lewis, Jerusalem. Now that's how long we've been under this curse, these curses. She don't understand that. But it sounds to me Robert E. Lee did. But Yah, righteousness, Jerusalem, and the Holy See. Q&A to follow. Y'all bless.